Honorable Vice President of India, Venkaiah Naidu ji, he has released that last time. And along with this institution, for seminar also, this time also we have the plan of releasing this data. And I don't know how many of you know about it, that the later data which has been released by the LDCIL, it is free for research, and it can be enriched the development of Indian languages through technology and other aspects. Especially you talk about automatic dictation or speech recognition, language understanding, or machine translation, and so on, grammar, and all those things. These datas are very much useful. Actually, this is a kind of social research, like languages under the Central Institute of Indian Languages, through LDCIL, it serves to the humanity that how the cutting edges on IT tools in Indian languages. But how many of you know about the active involvement of Government of India in the technology? In the budget, that is not the previous one, it is 2020 and 21. The finance minister, she has quoted, "The data is the new oil." Our finance minister quoted, "Data is the new oil." We all know that the economy of the nation is designed by how much wealth you have in oil in your nation. So now, really, it is a need of the hour to understand that data is the new oil. Already, LDCIL, it has a lot of data, and we are rich in that. And to enrich more and more, because language is not static, it is so dynamic. So always it needs more data to be accumulated, and it should be used for future. So at this juncture, I'm so privileged and happy and honored to welcome our director, Professor Venkatesha Murthy sir, to give an introductory speech and presidential address. Our director is so enthusiastic and is very encouraging, though he has more responsibilities by his post and other engagements. He has agreed, sir, I'm welcoming you for this seminar.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
And also, the CIL is proud to announce that it has lined up with the most eminent scholars and experts across the country and spectrum. Because it doesn't confine itself with only academia, but the technological industry and the scholars whose ministries involved this language technology. For example, we have arranged for a lecture by the Technology Development for Indian Languages by the Ministry, Electronics and Information and Technology. So the team is with us, and they'll give a lecture, and followed by. So I'm welcoming the team of experts who's going to deliver a lecture. TDIL team, I'm welcoming all the members to this seminar. And we have next lecture by Professor Girish Nath Jha. He is from the Jawaharlal Nehru University. He has been associated with not only with the LDCIL, and is all the projects and developments, he is supporting us. So I'm welcoming Professor Girish Nath Jha from the JNU for his lecture. And also, I told you, it is not only confined with academic people. We have invited Dr. Monjit from the Microsoft Research, sir, welcoming you for this seminar, followed by the panel discussions. For that also, wider range of in different areas, we have invited people. So I'm welcoming all the members. Sri Ajay Kumar from Pune, Professor Rohit from Guwahati IIT, and Mr. Rajin from Samsung, Mr. Raghu from Airtel, Anup from Microsoft, And that will be, that panel discussion will be moderated by the Dr. Narayan Chaudhary is an officer in charge LDCIL, who's the main brain behind this seminar, and he's also an assistant director. So I'm welcoming all the panel discussion team. And unless we have not received a very good response from all the participants who have participated, it won't come to an end. And so I am very warm welcome to all the participants who are taking part in different areas. I'm very warm welcome on behalf of Central Institute of Indian Languages and LDCIL. I have many of my colleagues, almost all my colleagues have joined. And also our former director, Professor D.P. Patnaik, is the founder director of Central Institute. He is also joining this workshop. So a very warm welcome. And with that, I request all the people to take care of your health, stay safe, and we can fight against corona. And very warm welcome on behalf of Central Institute of Indian Languages and LDCIL to this seminar.
Thank you so much, Professor Fernandez, for welcoming all the dignitaries and expert guests for this seminar. Now I invite Professor C.G. Venkateshamurthy, Director of CIIL, for the introductory speech and presidential address. Professor C.G. Venkateshamurthy is an educationist who has served NCERT for over 30 years and has contributed to school education tremendously. Sir, please join us for the presidential address. Thank you, sir, for your presidential address. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Esteemed ladies and gentlemen, and my professional colleagues, I welcome you all to this seminar scheduled online, which is the norm of the day in the present circumstances. I hope all of you are sitting in your comfort of your homely environment, and you will enjoy some of the remarkably interesting talks, discussions, and lectures we are going to witness today during the current seminar focused on a very highly competitive and in-demand technology discipline focused on language and linguistics. Central Institute of Indian Languages is the apex body of Government of India, which is entrusted with the responsibility of promotion of Indian languages in all areas, including that of information technology, which is rather new, considering that CIL has been in existence for the last 50 years and slightly more. Being the apex body of Government of India, focused on promotion of all Indian languages, of course, except Hindi, Urdu, and Sanskrit, for which separate institutions of the Government of India exist. The Central Institute of Indian Languages has a unique place among all the existing language institutions in India. It is an organization in India that works on all major, minor, and endangered or lesser known languages of India, and works for the promotion of all, either by directly undertaking projects on them or collaborating with other organizations or language institutions. The Indian languages have been underrepresented on the internet and in the information technology in general. Of course, there are multiple causes for this. The Indian languages started getting support as late as 2005 in electronic platform, when the Unicode support came for these languages with the efforts of the Government of India and international bodies. In 2016, the Government of India made it mandatory for any electronic device with a language interface and sold in India to have the support of Indian languages. This has led the industry to look for resources that can support the Indian languages. It is beneficial also for the industry, as more languages are supported on an electronic device, the more acceptable it becomes for all language community. The key ingredient for any type of language technology is a language resource on which the technology is trained, tested, and evaluated. Predicting the need of linguistic resources for information technology research and development in Indian languages, very early, the Central Institute of Indian Languages proposed for a scheme of linguistic data consortium for Indian languages called LDCIL to the Ministry of Education in 2005. After almost 2 years of discussion on this at various levels, the scheme was approved by the ministry to be established in 2007 with the goal that the scheme will get support from the government for 6 years, after which it will stand on its own by generating its own revenue by way of sale proceeds of the resources it creates. While the resources started being prepared since 2008, it took a lot of time to finally release them for industry and academic research. The delay was due to copyright issues and costing policy, which got resolved only in 2019, when the Honorable President of India released 31 data sets in 11 languages, Indian languages, through the data distribution portal of LDCIL. All of these 31 data sets are raw speech and text corpora with no annotations done over them. All these 31 data sets have generated around 1.35 crores of revenue in the last 2 years. Continuing with the same, today we are also going to release 11 additional data sets, again raw speech and text, covering 5 additional languages of India, including Assamese, Kashmiri, Gujarati, Odia, and Tamil. Additionally, we are also releasing 2 varieties of Indian English, as we consider the Indian English also has its own varieties, which are peppered with linguistic features of the region which it is spoken. So we have Karnataka English and Bengali English as part of this release. The scheme of Linguistic Data Consortium for Indian Languages, LDCIL, was established with the goals of creating linguistic resources required for the development of language technology in India. While we do not indulge directly in developing the technology, we provide the raw materials which form the building blocks for technology development in Indian languages. This scheme is based on a similar agency called Linguistic Data Consortium, situated at the University of Pennsylvania, USA. A similar other non-profit organization called European Language Resource Association, ELRA, which came up later, also in Europe, catering primarily to European languages. Friends, the Government of India is committed for the promotion of all these languages with greater boost. This year also, the Government of India has allocated around 500 crore budget layout for the new scheme implemented by MEITY, focused on creating more linguistic resources for Indian languages. In recent times, the area of data science and artificial intelligence has gained momentum, and these technologies are being experimented with new languages on a daily basis, both by the industry and in the academia. The major constraint of experimenting with such state-of-the-art techniques is that they require large data, language data sets, which is hard to come up by for more and many of the Indian languages. Being a government agency, projects like LDCIL and Bharatvani have gathered sizable language resources that can be readily deployed for such experiments, and Indian languages will get more technology support. Research is in the area of natural language processing, the subfield of artificial intelligence, focused on language technology, are finding it difficult to get large data sets. The resources readied by LDCIL are available for them at no cost for academic and non-profit ones. Similarly, industry or startups working in this area can leverage these data sets at a minimum license fee and come up with a technology supporting these languages. The data sets are of high quality as have already been used by many researchers and industrial entities, including MNCs and startups. Today, we have several eminent experts, eminent speakers in this seminar, who will shed more light on the nuances of the language resources and its importance and use cases in the technology development for Indian languages. In the audience also, we have several highly skilled and dedicated academicians and software engineers who have dedicated years of their research in this area. I believe that while this seminar will give some insights to the young minds in audience, this will also leave some takeaways for the government and other developing agencies like CIIL, TDIL, and CDAC, who are also participating in this seminar. These takeaways would be in terms of suggestions we get from the experiences of the technology practitioners. I understand that the audience in this event also includes students, researchers, professors, and industry professionals, and they have all faced such issues during this, their own researches. I hope you all can benefit out of these data sets, and we will be able to break a language barrier that technology has created by supporting all languages on all types of electronic devices. I would like to also assure the research community in this area that soon after this, we are going to release new data sets in Indian languages that would be more sophisticated and will have deeper annotations done on them that can be readily deployed in development of technologies such as automatic speech recognition, textual language modeling, and so on. The best thing about LDCIL is that it does not make a difference between small and big languages. It distributes its resources equitably for all constitutional languages. And that's why we have been able to garner some resources even for languages like Kashmiri, Maithili, Dogri, Bodo, and so on, along with major languages of India, like Hindi, Bengali, Tamil, and so on. I believe that in the near future, the language technologies would gain greater prominence and permeance in Indian society, and to make this area more just for anyone to work with, the LDCIL will continue to play a big role. This is the assurance from the Central Institute of Indian Languages. I thank all of you for having been able to make it possible to be a part of this seminar. I wish this seminar a good luck and looking forward to having professional sessions and discussions. Thank you very much. Namaskar. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your presidential address. We are enlightened so much from your address. This is the occasion when we all feel very proud to be a part of CIIL. Even in this pandemic situation, we all worked so hard to release some data sets from LDCIL. Now, I would like to welcome Dr. Narayan Chaudhary, Officer in Charge of LDCIL and Assistant Director Admin in Charge of CIIL, to make a presentation on release of data sets and books by LDCIL.
Thank you, Sonali. And thank you, Professor Venkatesh Purthi, Professor Fernandez, for starting the seminar with a sound and a nice note, which is an upbeat thing for all of us. So let me give you a brief on this seminar. we have got more than 350 registration requests on Google Meet and through the forms, but the Google Meet kind of subscription that we have, it allows us only for 250 participants. So we have given invitations only for 250 participants to be registered based on their affiliation and the kind of designations they hold. The rest of the participants may watch all the proceeds of this seminar on YouTube Live and also on Facebook. The link has already been shared on Facebook. So to start with that, now I would like to give a brief on what LECIL stands for and give you also a brief of the new data sets that we are releasing today. So let me quickly share my screen with all of you. So I believe my screen is visible. Is it visible on the screen, Sonali?
Getting open. It's getting open, Dr. Narayan.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
it's visible. It is visible, sir.
Okay, fine. So one more announcement that I have to make, that this was supposed to be released by our Joint Secretary of Ministry of Education, Srimati Anita Prasad, but due to an urgent meeting of hers with the minister, she was not able to attend today's seminar. And now the data sets are going to be released by our own director, Professor C.G. Venkatesh Murthy. So this is a total of 11 data sets and additionally one compendium, which gives an overview of all the new data sets that we are releasing today. So I'll move ahead and start giving you a brief of what we are doing with this. Now, before we start with the LECIL, it is paramount that I give some brief intro of the Central Institute of Indian Languages. I believe that there are quite a lot of new people and young people who might not be very much aware of Central Institute of Indian Languages. So Central Institute of Indian Languages is a statutory body of Government of India, as Professor Murthy has already stated in his speech. But it also advises the Government of India on all matters relating to Indian languages. It implements the language-related policies of the Government of India, runs five separate schemes, which are focused on different goals towards the various types of linguistic research and development of Indian languages, like a National Translation Mission, National Testing Services, four languages for the classical language centers, namely Kannada, Telugu, Malayalam, and Odia. It also has a grant in aid scheme through which we have four verticals using which we support different types of language and literary activities in Indian languages. And this grant in aid is, promotes all 121 languages that are designated as such by the Census of India. And of course, LECIL is also one of the schemes. Now, we also have two major projects. For some of you people, let me give you a brief of the difference between scheme and a project. Scheme is something which gets approved with the approval of the Niti Aayog, or earlier what we used to call as the Planning Commission, because all these schemes were approved earlier by the Planning Commission, which is now being designated as the Niti Aayog. But we have two projects. Namely SPEL, which is the short form of Scheme for Protection and Preservation of Endangered Languages, wherein we focus on the languages that are spoken by less than 10,000 people in India. And we have another project of the institute called Bharatvani, wherein we are trying to gather all the types of knowledge content in 121 languages of India. Out of that, if you look at the Bharatvani portal, which is bharatvani.org, you will see that we are supporting close to 98 languages. And we have garnered content in all of these languages from different sources, including the private publishers, by getting into an agreement with them and then asking them to give your content to us. And to do it exclusively shared on the Bharatvani portal, which can later be accessed by anyone else who wants to do anything else with the data for these languages. So this was a brief of CIL. Now let's come to this LDCIL, because this seminar is focused on the work that we are doing in LDCIL. So this LDCIL, Linguistic Data Consortium for Indian Languages, was envisaged in 2006 and became functional in 2007. This is a central sector scheme implemented by CIL Mysore with the goals as given below, to become a repository of linguistic resources in all Indian languages in the form of text, speech, and lexical corpus. It also aims to facilitate creation of such databases by different organizations which would contribute and enrich the main LDCIL repository. It also sets appropriate standards for data collection and storage of corpora for different research and development activities, of course, in consultation with other stakeholders in this industry and the research academia, like universities, the institutes, industry, and of course, the Bureau of Indian Standards. It also supports language technology development and sharing of tools for language-related data collection and management. It facilitates training and manpower development in these areas through workshops, seminars in technical as well as process-related issues. A brief on the people who have been involved in this scheme. So officers in charge are a lower level officers who are directly responsible for managing all the works of the scheme. And you can see that we have had three. So Professor Dr. B. Mallikarjun from 2007 to 2010 when it was started, and then continued by Dr. Ramamurthy, who retired in 2019. And I also joined the team in 2017, and I'm continuing until now. The scheme was envisaged during the time of Professor Uday Narayan Singh. And thereafter, we have had six directors, including Rajesh Sasdeva, S.N. Burman, Avdesh Mishra, D.G. Rao, and now our own Professor Venkatesh Murthy. The scheme is supported by a total of 49 contractual positions that we have here, including 36 linguists, 6 technical resource persons, and 7 or administrative staff. So these are the activities that we have done so far. I mean, in linguistic resources, in language resources, there are quite a lot of things that we can do, but we have to make headway stepwise on where and how to begin with. So we started off with creating raw text for all the scheduled languages of India and spread to speech domain, including some works in the Indian Sign Language. Now, it is very easy to just say this, but let me give you a brief on when we started, how difficult was that task. You would know that internet is now a very common thing, but when the project started, let's say in 2007, most of the Indian language did not have even the Unicode support. You did not have any electronic content over the internet. So the only option that you had was to get content from the hard printed books, newspapers, magazines, and then select text from there, get it typed, get it proofread, then put it in an electronic format, and then say that, okay, you have got this raw text corpus. Most of the data set that we have in LSEL are of that kind. And this type of text you would not find anywhere else, even on the internet, even at present, because the texts that are coming here, they are coming from books, textbooks, fiction, non-fiction, different types of other types of text. So that shows the difficulty and the kind of effort that has been, that has gone into creating even the raw text. The other major areas of work that we have are this, like say a text corpus creation, parts of speech annotation, then chunking over that, that is like local world grouping. Then we also go into speech corpora creation, and all the speech corpora creation, when we say it means that all the speech corpora that is required for ASR purposes, for TTS, we do not have any kind of corpus developed yet, but we hope that we'll go into that also soon. Then after you have the speech corpora created, then we do a sentence level annotation of all the speech data that we collect from the field, from the respective field. Let's say, for example, when we collected the speech corpora, we went into the field. So if we had to collect, let's say, as many speech corpus, we went to different places in Assam with a team of, let's say, four people. And they spent months along contacting people, getting their consent, giving them, preparing the prompts, and then asking them to, okay, read out in the natural way that you would read those sentences. And then come back here with the speech data and do the annotation. First, for raw speech, we simply do a rough kind of a segmentation. And then after that, we go into the sentence level annotation of the speech data. And we also go into word level annotation, but word level annotation we have now stopped, but we have some data that is already done at the word level using the tools like Prath. We also have a small subset of Indian sign language data that we collected when we had a couple of sign language experts here at CII. And now, so we started distributing the data starting from 2019. And of course, I can say that there were a lot of hurdles. You may ask us, why did it take so much of time to release these data sets? And this has already been discussed, and probably you might find some of the details of the hardship that we faced before we could release the data sets on our LSEL portal. But let me also give you a brief on two major issues that were working as a bottleneck for us to release the data sets. These were first the copyright issues, because we had got the text extracted from different types of books which were copyrighted by different authors, different publishers, different organizers, and we had not got the copying rights from them. So we had to do a hectic job of more than contacting more than 50,000 people across India and even sometimes abroad, asking them for a consent on using the extract from their text and then use it for this purpose. And this took a lot of time, and we finalized it sometime in 2018. That was one issue. Another issue was that, as you have seen, in Professor Murthy's speech, he has stated that the scheme of LSEL was established in 2007, and with the goal that after 6 years, it would stand on its own. It would create its own revenue and would be able to support its own staff, just on the model of, let's say, ELRA or the LSE of University of Pennsylvania. However, that has not happened. But it was mandatory for us to come up with some kind of a costing, guidelines or policy that we could use to give a price tag to the data sets that we are releasing. So that also took a time. It was a hectic task, but finally we cleansed it in 2018. with the approval of the PAC and the other members. And we have got the pricing thing finalized, which is a win-win thing for both the academia and different types of commercial bodies. So for academia, we are giving all the data sets for free for non-commercial use. But for commercial use, we charge a kind of small portion of license fee. And that license fee is very nominal. So anyone, let's say we sell our data set to an MNC like Microsoft or Google or Samsung, we charge them something like 10% of the total cost that would go into creating a similar kind of resource in Indian languages at present rate. So that is like they would be getting the data set for 10% of the total cost that it has. But for startups, it is also smaller. They get around 60% of discount. Sorry, 80% of discount. They get the total the data set only for 20% of the amount. But for academic research, non-commercial purposes, if a student, if a faculty wants to access the data set, they can simply get it for free by following some small procedures. Now, data distribution, as some of you might have already seen, who might have registered on our data portal, the link of which is given here, that it is semi-automatic. It is not automatic. Now, you cannot simply go to the website, register it, log in, and click on the download button, and you get the whole data. That is not there because the data sets are very high in size, very large in size. And the servers, let's say it would be in GBs, hundreds of GBs. So we do not allow people to simply download it because we have some bandwidth issues. So we ask them to get it via what you say, kind of some kind of a media that either they send, to us, or we procure for them, and then we send the data to them over the physical media that are procured. Now, data, of course, is available for non-commercial purposes. This data portal was released on 4th April 2019 by the Honorable Vice President of India. And these are some of the basic features of the data portal. First, government portal distributing linguistic data for both commercial and non-commercial. This is a major thing even to get started. If the data is free, so let's say, for example, you have another portal called data.gov.in, where different types of data are provided by the different government agencies, central government agencies, or even state government agencies for free for both commercial and non-commercial use. But they do not use any commercial mechanism. And that is why we are not giving our data, the LCL data, on that portal. So you cannot get this data set on that portal. However, you can have some of the listing, like say PDIL is also coming up with its own another kind of portal, language resource portal, where you will not be able to just simply get the data resources, but also different types of tools and softwares that TDIL has supported so far, and they are going to make it open source. You can get all of those things also there. But the LCL dataset will also be hosted. The catalog of it would be hosted on their portal. The same thing is also probably ELRA, European Language Resource Association. They have also promised that they are going to host our catalog on their portal. So that would also be a feature. So anyone who wants to search any kind of data, they can have a look at these things and make best use of it. Now, registration is automatic, but request has to be raised. Now, automatic registration only for commercial users. For non-commercial users, we need to verify whether the non-commercial user is a bona fide student or a faculty at any of the Indian university. Each dataset comes with a detailed documentation and systematic structure that can be readily used for various tasks. Now, the documentation of each of the data set you can get for free on the data portal, if you are a registered user, even the sample data are available for download for all the registered users. These are, we have got a total of around 13 speech data sets that are currently available. I mean, until yesterday was available for this two. Now we have got 11. So if you are looking at the data portal now, you would be getting more data sets because we have added 10 new speech data sets on that. But earlier we had 13 data sets that were already released. Then we also had 18 text data sets already released for 18 different languages, and we are going to have one more language. So total language being supported in text is right now 19. These are some of the ancillary works of LDCI. So we have frequent word lists, frequency word list in the scheduled languages. We have some tools like say automatic transliteration, and this is done using a single transliteration schema, which you can see on the LDCI portal also. And if anyone wants to have a look at that, you can simply download it from our LDCI portal. We also have ISCII to Unicode converter. Now ISCII is another kind of a schema which the Indian government started, developed with the help of CDAC to encode the Indian languages. So that was a different kind of, encoding system. But later on, because Unicode also started supporting all the Indian languages, so ISCII was no longer needed. So we had to convert some of the texts that were prepared in ISCII to Unicode and then make use of it. We also have some other tools like, say, frequency analyzers. And we also train manpower in NLP and related activities across India by way of conducting seminars, workshops, etc., or collaborating with the organizations for the language technology related topics, including the seminars, conferences that happen across India. Now, so these are some of the works that we have already done for the raw text corpora. So we have two different types of text corpora. One is what we call as the typed. This is like say, we got the book, we got it typed from the actual books, magazines or newspapers. And then we did some kind of a proofreading over them. And then we moved ahead with that. Typed text were doubly verified by proofing, alleviating spelling error issues. Copyright issues were taken care of by taking the permission from the respective stakeholders. And extracts from around 50,000 titles across the concerned language, as I had stated earlier. So these are the some vital stats of the raw text corpora. You can see we have got a total of 20 languages listed here, but we have released only 19. One language is not listed, released yet. That is probably Sindhi because of some other issues. This is a completed works on the parts of the speech annotation corpora. We have parts of the speech annotation done for many of the languages, but it has not been released because of evaluation. I mean, the annotation has been done by one person, another person has not checked it, so round robin method has not been followed. That is why we have not released it, but we hope that we will do it very soon. And this is a small snippet of giving the details of the POS annotated work. You can see that some of the languages have more than 1 million tokens annotated. And that I think is well enough for any kind of a POS target to be developed for that language. And some chunking has also been done for some of the languages. But again, this also has not been evaluated, that is why it is pending. And this is some vital stat for the chunking process that we have done. So you can see that some languages have more than 5 lakh chunk labels, which is huge. But for some languages, it is very small. We have got 14 languages so far done at this level. These are the computer works for the speech data. So it is available in 19 languages. And you can see that with the release today, you will have 18 languages already released. So we hope that in the near future, we are going to release first the sentence alignment, done for all of these corpora, one part. Another part, I can understand that the size of the data that we have is not big enough for a deep learning system to work with, but maybe some other algorithms coupled with some linguistic inputs may work on it. But we hope that in near future, we'll augment all of these speech data with the very high numbers. And we have already started work towards this. And hopefully in near future, we'll have hundreds of hours of additional data added to the same speech data sets. Now, in the speech data, we have got different types of things. As anyone who works in the ASR, they would know that when you are working on converting the speech signals into the text, you would need to also identify what type of text is being spoken. So we have these different types of categories already categorized. And when you see any of our data sets, you will see that all of these things are separately done. So if you are working, let's say, only on the text, then you will be able to segment it or filter it and then put it in a different way. I mean, make use in whatever way you want. And this is the vital stats of the segmented data mapped with corresponding data. This is the raw text for all the languages. All of these details you can see on the data portal also for each of the different language pages. Now, computer works for speech data annotated at sentence level. We have got some sizable sentence level annotated data for speech as well. So let's say for Tamil, you have got 72 hours of sentence level annotated data, which is something that can be readily used for ASR development. Now, we start with this Indian Sign Language corpus. As I had stated that earlier, we have some small amount of speech sign language corpus also, and we get quite a lot of requests also from both technology and academia, academics asking for this data. But the issue is that we have, there is some additional work that needs to be done on that before it can be released. And we are not finding the right kind of resources. We are also in talk with the Indian Sign Language Institute that we established a couple of years back. But we hope that in the near future, we'll have something done over this so that Indian Sign Language also gets some kind of a support, and we would be able to use this data to do automatic translation from any Indian language to Indian Sign Language. This is the major part. So 13 languages for raw speech data segmented para-wise, story-wise. More languages getting finalized for release, and data segmented at sentence level being prioritized over other tasks, and we hope to start releasing these data from next time. It is going to be done from today itself. Now, this is the data portal stats. Some of you are already aware of the data portal, and if you are interested, let me give you this small brief. That we, out of the 31 data sets that we have released so far, and which are only raw text and raw speech corpus, no annotations done yet. So this data set has generated a total of 1.25 crores. And we have got a total of around 600 registered users on the portal. Now, I have not given any detail of the expenditure that we have already made so far, let's say in 12 years of our existence, the existence of this scheme. But to give you a brief, we have spent something around 25 crores so far, 25 crores of rupees. And this amount is, of course, very paltry, but we hope that once we start releasing the annotated data sets, the revenues will also generate, and this will probably boost our case, and we will impress upon the government that okay, now is the time that you make LDCI a separate 6 and 8 company, or maybe some kind of a non-government organization, or maybe an autonomous body with some support from the government. But at the same time, it should also be able to generate its own funds and manage its own works towards the promotion of Indian languages. This is a brief of the vital stats of the Indian Sign Language Corpus. If just in case any one of you are interested in this kind of a thing, and if anyone is interested in taking it up forward on the Indian Sign Language Corpus, like say enriching it or making use of it or doing any further task, you may please contact us, and we will have some kind of a collaboration on this, and we can take it forward from here. I mean, right now at CIL, we do not have anyone who is an expert at sign language, so we are still in search of someone who can work on this. Now, these are the ongoing works with some priority. So sentence level segmentation and annotation of existing speech corpora is the first priority. And quite a few languages have already completed, but we have not yet released because we want a third party evaluation of these things done. So once it is done, we will start releasing this data set also. Similar is the status of the pure stack data and chunk data. Evaluation is pending. Once we have the evaluations done, we'll start releasing them. We believe that TTS is also something that we should indulge into, because we have a very good studio here. We can select some good voice talents and ask them to come over here, record the thing, and then make it available for anyone who wants to develop their own TTS in the open domain. So let us hope that in the coming near future, we'll start some work on TTS also, and we'll release it. So these are our future goals. So right now we have got some requests that please, upload our data on the data portal, but we have not yet done because it requires some kind of a policy and some kind of an approval from the PAC. So we hope that we'll conduct our PAC soon with some ideas on how to work as a facilitator of all sorts of linguistic resources with a small evaluation mechanism in place. And anyone who has developed any kind of language corpus at their own end, as an individual or as an organization, they can share the data with us, and we can post it on our portal. Of course, with the revenue sharing mechanism that is that would be finalized. It would also publish data sets other than in-house productions with the royalty sharing mechanism. And it will enhance existing data sets with the new data collection mechanism. And when we say new data collection mechanism, I'm saying that we are working on developing a kind of an app using which we can collect the data set remotely from the speakers using the mobile devices. So the work is still on that, and we hope that soon it will be finalized. And we will have that mechanism in place wherein we can collect the data sets from the voluntary persons, of course, with some kind of remuneration being given to them. And we will, of course, collaborate with other organizations for creation of more data sets useful for NLP research works. So now we come to the last part of it, the focus of today. So these are the new data sets that we are going to release today. One is a text corpus of ASMEs containing more than 1 million words. It has got 6 domains and it is priced at 77,380 rupees. This is for, let's say, the top category, commercial category. So do not get afraid of the high price for these things. So for non-commercial users, for academic users, bona fide such users, it is given without any license fee. It is only for the commercial users. And we have got 10 raw speech corpora, including one multilingual corpus. So we have got ASMEs raw corpus, Dogri raw corpus, Gujarati. And in Gujarati, we have got two because there was some issue in recording at that time. When we were recording, there was some kind of a mistake that happened at that time. So some of the data that we recorded in the field, the recorder was switched to mono settings. So some of the data that we have are in stereo and some of the data that we have is in mono. And that is why two different types of data sets. I know that this affects the a training model and that is why it is really new, but maybe some models are there which would like to use the mono recording as well. That is why it is being released as a separate data set. And of course we have Indian English variants for Bengali and Kannada, and then we have Kashmiri, Odia and Tamil, and then we also have a multilingual raw speech corpus covering a total of 19 languages. Now this multilingual raw corpus, this idea came because we had got a request from somewhere in IIT Kanpur. Some person was doing some kind of a language identification module, and they wanted different types of small data set for different languages. And there we developed that that thing, and we made available to them as a separate request. But now we are also releasing it as a separate item for anyone who wants to take a research or experiment with different types of language signals. So simple things. So this is a gold standard ASMEs raw text corpus. And these are the two things. For ASMEs, we have got both the things covered now. So we have a raw speech corpus and raw text corpus, both of the things done. Then this is the Kashmiri corpus. Then we have got the Odia and Tamil. Then Gujarati, both types of corpus, raw speech corpus, raw text corpus we had released earlier itself. So no text corpus for Gujarati. Indian English corpus. And then this multilingual raw speech corpus. And on top of this, we also have this compendium of linguistic resources. It includes all the documentations of all of these new data sets put together in a single book. This book is an ebook release, and you can find it on LDCIL portal, all the book, free of cost, at no cost. And these are the vital stats of these this release. So you can see ASMEs raw corpus is 54 hours, Dogri is 17 hours. I know some languages are very small. Gujarati speech stereo recording is 57, Gujarati mono is 64. Indian language, Bengali variant is 25 hours. Indian English, Kannada variant is 23 hours, Kashmiri is 28. Multilingual raw speech is 97 hours, Odia is 138 hours, and Tamil is 139 hours. And the cost is also given in Indian rupees here. So that is it. Now I request Professor Venkatesh Murthy to give his consent to release the data sets.
Please go ahead and we will release them. Yes, thank you. We are very proud to release these things and I hope this will be useful for all the stakeholders. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everybody. So that was the end of it. I would request all of you to go and visit this data portal, see the data set. If you have any queries, you can send an email to us at oic-lecl@gov.in. We would be happy to help on any kind of issues on this. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Narayan Chaudhary, Officer in Charge, LDCIL, for your informative presentation. Now it is time for vote of thanks. I request Dr. Vijayalakshmi F. Patil to give a vote of thanks.
Good morning, everybody. It's my privilege to have been asked to propose vote of thanks on this occasion. On behalf of LDCIL, Central Institute of Indian Languages, Mysore, I extend a very hearty vote of thanks to the driving force of this institute, Professor C.G. Venkateshamurthy, the Director, Central Institute of Indian Languages, Mysore, for his introductory speech and presidential address, and also to grace this occasion. I would like to thank our beloved Professor P.R. Dharmesh Fernandes, Deputy Director, Central Institute of Indian Languages, Mysore, for his graceful welcome address. I like to thank our source of inspiration, Officer in Charge, come Assistant Director of this institute, Dr. Narayan Chaudhary sir, for his wonderful presentation on LDCIL and its 11 new data sets. We are grateful to all experts and language developers who are going to speak on different topics on this occasion. We convey our sincere thanks to all the participants for their active and enthusiastic participation. I'm also thankful to our staff whose meaningful endeavor made a great success towards invitations, registration management, technical arrangements, and other related works. Finally, I would like to thank you all for being with us and hope we will have a thoughtful discussion in the first half. All of us definitely draw some precious information, knowledge, and ideas, which will for sure help and promote Indian languages in coming future. Have a great day ahead. Thank you all.
Thank you, Vijayalakshmi Patil. Now we have already come up to the first part of the seminar. Welcome to the second stage of the seminar. At this stage, we will have three lectures as per the schedule. Each lecture is assigned a total of 30 minutes, including time on question answer session right after the lecture. The audience is requested to write their questions on Google Meet or on the live feed on YouTube and Facebook. Valid questions will be picked up and presented before the speakers to respond. The first lecture is on the topic of ULCA compliant open source corpus building by team from TDIL, Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, Government of India. The team is headed by Shri Vijay Kumar, who is a senior scientist at the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology and leading the Technology Development for Indian Languages program, which is TDIL program of the ministry. Shri Vijay Kumar has been with the TDIL program for more than two decades and has a vast experience of handling various types of projects that TDIL has funded and implemented through various universities, institutes, and organizations within India. Shri Vijay Kumar is also a part of the recently announced Natural Language Translation Mission program of the ministry. I welcome Shri Vijay Kumar for his lecture. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. Good morning to all of you. I am pleased to participate in this event organized by CIL Mysore for releasing data sets and share our perspective on building a data-driven, AI-based speech-to-speech machine translation system to to connect the masses with each other. Language barrier is one of the impediments for economic progress. There is a requirement for automatic speech recognition for common man to speak to the machines and text-to-speech for machine to speak back with required information. Even text information is majorly available in English only, except for few languages like textbooks, information of government schemes, crop advisory, etc. And therefore, there is a requirement for automatic translation from English to all major Indian languages. Under National Language Translation Mission, it is envisaged to build a public digital platform serving machine translation system with potential application programming interfaces used to translate text and speech content from one language to another with minimal human involvement. Under this mission, open speech and text data corpus in a large number of domains, including governance and policy, and in multiple Indian languages will be created through a national public digital platform by leveraging freelancers, language service providers, and startups through a dynamic e-marketplace, which will be an integral part of the platform. The other target is to create and nurture an ecosystem involving startups, central state government agencies, working together to develop and deploy innovative products and services in Indian languages. It is also envisaged to increase the content in Indian languages on the internet substantially in the domains of public interest, particularly governance and policy, science and technology, in coordination with various state governments and other stakeholders. MeitY has initiated a pilot project for developing prototype speech technologies for Indian languages like Indian English, Tamil, Hindi language. But these are basically the language pairs that I am talking about. English-Hindi pair, English-Marathi, Hindi-Telugu, these pairs, and optical character recognition system for Kannada language. Under this project, IIT has conducted challenge rounds in speech and machine translation technologies, and startups have been engaged for building the training data sets. Under the project, data sets will be developed and made available in open domain, and they are like 1900 hours of ASR data, 120 hours of TTS data, 5 lakh sentences of parallel corpora for chemistry, law domain for building Hindi, Telugu, MT system, and 10 lakh sentences parallel corpora for Lok Sabha domain, 10 lakh sentence parallel corpora for law and tourism, and 10,000 image corpus for building Kannada OCR for building desktop and mobile applications. It is a pleasure to see CIL Mysore consistently releasing data sets for various Indian languages. I am sure that the deliberations that will take place today will further lay stress on the importance of data sets for building good NLP applications for Indian languages. Now I hand over to Ekstep Foundation team for sharing the concept of ULCA compliant open source corpus building. Thank you, everyone.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Kumar Deepak. I represent Ekstep Foundation, and we are actively participating in building and driving ULCA schemes and the software behind it. I'll share my screen so I can walk you through the presentation. Just let me know once you start seeing the screen. Is visible?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So, starting ULCA, that's what I'm here from Ekstep. So, ULCA stands for Universal Language Contribution APIs. We have envisaged ULCA as a open source and an open schema platform, where anyone and everyone can submit, release their data sets, models, or even can take care of or can benchmark their model against any models that are available out in the public. So under this OLCA is an initiative under NLTM. That's how NLTM architecture looks like. What you're seeing here is OLCA layer is OLCA can be thought as a backbone or as a bearer that enables or funnels the above layer, which is depicted in the current diagram. So effectively, as you can see, that what OLCA stands for, it effectively provides that a training data set, benchmark data set, and the various models that are continuously built by the startups, institute, and the various initiative of METI. So this entire infrastructure is enabled by a layer which is is API driven, enabled and accessible for everyone. Obviously, there will be some security mechanism in place so that a system should not be misused by anyone. So having said so, the OLCA layer from the down, you can see the OLCA stands for the bottom three layers. And what it stands for, so any crowdsourcing application that is out there can be built by startups, can be built by various initiative of various institutes. They can actually plug their information into OLCA using these using the OPI, open APIs. We have various benchmarking tools, which again can plug into OLCA, various OPI, open APIs that can plug into OLCA, along with the various leaderboards, so that let's think about a use case that a researcher who's looking for a very specific, let's say English, Marathi data set. And he or she wants to look at, okay, do we have any translation model or ASR model that is for, let's say, Marathi language or let's say for Maghi language. So the researcher can come into the system, they can search, they can look at a data set, they can look at the benchmark against the model that has that has run on that that data set and how that model is performing. So effectively, it enables a researcher or a startup or anyone in the ecosystem to look at the various information related to models, related to data set, and even the benchmark data set. Once so we call this a foundation layer where, as I said, since it's open spec driven, so we encourage that all of us should participate to make sure that OLCA system remains very vibrant and effective for our Indian language development. So I'll take you to the next slide, which effectively talks more about what OLCA stands for, which I have. So OLCA is a METI initiative. It's an open source scalable data platform. It supports various types of data set that is out there. We can think as a central repository where the data which currently stays at in various silos can have their representation here. We also talk about why it is required and how OLCA can make sure that the data set will remain accessible to everyone whosoever is interested in. So OLCA has as I said, OLCA is a repository. A repository has an interface which the user can use to visualize. Effectively, the user can look at, okay, what kind of data set are available for my search criteria, what kind of model that are available for let's say translation problem, what kind of model that are available for, let's say, ASR. So these UI will enable, will make sure that user can find the information that is present in the OLCA repository. So why we are proposing OLCA? We wanted to make sure that the various data sets, the various initiative that is across that is spread out across Pan India, can be consolidated and shared with everyone. We are also envisaging there should be a single stop solution or a system where user can look at parallel data set, they can look at a monolingual data set, they can look at OCR, they can look at annotation, whatever data set the popular or the most important data set that is available in various silos can reside on OLCA. So how we are making sure that the data set which might be into various popular format can come into the can into Olka. We are saying that we have a streamlined data format, which that has been defined. As I said, this is an open standard, open specification. The open specification already being released, shared, and they are still out. So I can, after this presentation, I can share the Git repository where every one of you is most welcome to look at the specification. So that way, we are envisaging that the data set can be entered or can reside at Olka repository using these exposed or using these open API standards. Now we're also making sure that the data set, which is because a data set should belong to a contributor, so making sure that the proper credits are given to each one who has contributed to our data set till the record level. So Olka Specs enables that to make sure that the records are properly attributed, the records are properly various metadata can be used to enable effective searches, and the proper attribution or the valid attribution can be given to the user. Apart from that, since it behaves like a central repository, all the records, Olka system also makes sure that the records are not duplicated or the records. So how do we make sure that we do that? You know, we apply various canonical checks, we apply deduplication on that one, just to make sure that the records are not duplicated, record remains at the highest level of quality. And then finally, once the data set is migrated or inserted into Olka system, there is an interface. Again, it's an open interface that can the researcher can use that open interface to search on the data set record, across the record that is present on Olka. So you can just think how effective would be, like, even let's say that we are contributing, somebody else is contributing, and a researcher can search across on the submitted data set, instead of searching in the silos. So that's what Olka stands for. So another thing, we also have made sure that the quality of, how do we make sure that the quality of data set remains at the highest level? We apply various machine validation. For example, if it is a parallel corpus, we make sure that the parallel sentences entered has a proper alignment score. So these kind of checks, that is one of the, these are like auto machine generated or machine automated cases, making sure that all the records are in the proper format or the proper quality checks. And apart from that, a manual validation steps is also being introduced just to make sure that the data set remains at the highest quality of standards. So with this, I'll take you to the next slide. So, as I said, Olka is a open sourced system. The entire intention is to make sure that it goes back to the research community for various development of our Indic language. We think that a data set is an entry to barrier. Now if we lower down this barrier, lot of the participation can increase, which in turn funnels in innovation on that one. And we are making sure that since data set attribution remains to the user, so that the innovation done on these data set can also attribute to those users who have contributed to this open system. The whole point was to earn trust from the community, making sure that how the data sets, as I said, the codes, the checks, everything is in the public domain. So this means that anyone of us, like, most welcome to look at how Olka does the quality check on the data set, how Olka runs benchmark on the model results. So with this intent, the intent behind this was to gain trust from the community, to funnel innovation, and to increase participation from the contributor data set contributors by making sure that we give them proper credits. So what Olka is not is for, it honors the license specified by the submitter. So Olka is open source. It does not sell any kind of data set. So there are no commercial stuffs here. and it gives, you know, it gives full control of their data set. Yes, it only gives control to the submitter's data set, not on the other's data set. And ULCA acts like as a gatekeeper, making sure that the data that enters into a system remains at a highest quality level. I'll take a pause. If anybody has a question, then probably I can answer that. Then I'll go to the next slide. Okay. So, you know, beginning of this presentation, I was saying that what are the three prime contributions of ULCA? ULCA takes care, says that, okay, the data set is one of the prime contribution from the ULCA system toward the research community or toward the startup ecosystem. Rather, you know, any enthusiast, I will take a very blanket term, any enthusiast who is interested in, you know, on the AI technologies, you know, it enables, it keeps the user from the data set side. Second thing is the model side, and the third is the benchmark. That's what effectively does. It enables, it makes sure that it has all the repositories so that people can search, they can download a data set, they can run their own models, they can build their model, they can test the model which has been published by other researchers by running the benchmarks. And the benchmarks, yeah, and benchmarks has to be created, you know, with the highest gold standard data. So various stakeholders who are expert of benchmark curation and creation, various institute, so they can create, they can contribute on the benchmark data set. So currently, in the current release, which is scheduled on July this year, which is like in 2 weeks from now, we are making sure that the parallel corpus that exists in various silos of METI that comes on this platform. So these three data sets, these four data sets will be available on ULCA platform, the parallel corpus for machine translation problems, multilingual corpus, primarily from the point of view of LISTE language models, ASR-TTS corpus, and the OCR corpus. I believe, as Vijay sir has already said, that the numbers of data set that is present or be contributed by METI will reside on ULCA. So ULCA is a work in progress. We are making sure that all the pillars, those three pillars of ULCA, should see the day of light in coming months. The very first release will make sure the data set part is available for everyone, all of us. What we have also done, we have also released a largest public parallel corpus, which we call Samanantar, which is primarily meant for MT problems, which has like 50 million sentence pair. Various other data set from TDIL, CDAC, NLTM, IIT Bombay, IIT Madras, they are in process of converting into ULCA format, and all these data sets will be available for public consumption starting 1st July. So ULCA, coming to this one, we have three pillars to make sure that we have three pillars in our initiative. One is data set, the second thing is model, and the third pillar is benchmark. Now, with this as a benchmark, so making sure that, to increase the participation or increase the trust toward the, to the research community, we encourage everyone to participate in the, even in the development or even in the toward the contribution, both for model, data set, and even the benchmark part. So I'll come to the data set part just to elaborate. So I have said enough on the data set part. So what it does is, like, I'll quickly skim to this slide. Effectively, data set has four parts. All of us can submit. Anyone can submit with valid credentials. Once data set has been checked, diagnosed by the system, applied various validation techniques, data set will be published for the public consumption and with proper attribution. A user who has submitted data set can update their data set as well. And finally, the discovery. So discovery is given to, so we can think like this, you and me are submitting the data set, and let's say a new researcher or the new enthusiast can look at the data. So how do we do that? So as I said in the previous slides, we have defined and we have made sure that the various formats, very popular formats that exist in the format that exists in every domain is supported. And we have tried to define a unified schema for that, which is available at our Git repository. So the submission process is very simple. There are two files we are expecting from the user. Okay, it looks like it's like a data.json where the data resides, and we have params.json where all the parameters resides. We have data set specific definition resides. All user has to do, create these two files, zip the folder, and then push toward the Ulka using the interface that you see on the right hand side. It's as simple as that. Once the ingestion or the once the upload starts, when the validation process starts, various rules will be triggered based upon the dataset type under which it has been submitted. For example, let's say somebody wants to submit ASR. So we are making sure that if the person is saying that the file that is I'm submitting it has a format, but the specification says that the format is different from what the actual file is submitted. So Ulka makes sure that these kind of problems should not exist because the metadata or the information submitted by the submitter is different from the actual data. So Ulka will say that these records have problem and we cannot accept this with a proper valid reason, so that user it becomes very informative for the users why the data set upload has or the publish has failed. And if everything goes fine or the validation checks goes fine, a report will be generated saying that your data set has been published, you have submitted let's say n number of records, and we are contributing or we are saying that is your contribution toward Ulka system, and this information will be there out there in the public domain. So any kind of the information or the schema that I was talking about, how it enables all of us, any one of us, to make sure that data set can be made available at the center repository. So these are the various schema. As I said, we have made sure that the schema that we have defined, it already encapsulate most of the data formats, most of the parameters that exist across the data set that we are talking about. So please feel free to look at our GitHub link. Effectively, it's like a GitHub projectanua/Ulka. Please have a look at that. So a finer details how it effectively looks on the wire. So there are two files that you can see on the left and right. The left hand side represents parameters, and the right hand side is where the actual data resides. I can take you to further various details, like how we are making sure that the attribution goes to the actual till the record level. For example, I'll take a brief example. Let's say that if we take this example, English sentence has been translated by a person, Monica Chauhan. Even the translator can get attributed, even though it's been submitted by IIT Madras. IIT Madras is one of the contributor, and the record is contributed by Monica Chauhan. So Ulka takes care of at the both the levels. How much data is being submitted by a particular by entity, and how much data is being done at the user level. So this will funnel out that as a translator or as an annotator, I can also use Ulka, certificates, or I would say like attribution for Ulka, saying that these are the amount of work or this is the amount of contribution that I have made toward Ulka, till at the annotator level. Then I'll take you, these are various examples under various domain. For example, this slide talks about the ASR corpus. If you have noticed, effectively, the representation remains exactly same. As I said, most of the parameters that exist under the corpus that we talked about are being captured by our open specification. Yeah, this will be... Okay, So as we are saying that the validation is triggered for every record that we find that we push. This just we need to make sure that just to make sure that you know the data set remain at the highest quality level and all of the stakeholders and any person who is going to discover or use this information has a very valid and a clean data set for their model activity. So yeah, these are like public publish and attribution. Once we publish, we attribute all the people who are the submitter or the contributor of this data set. Similarly, we all talked about update and delete. As a contributor, I can delete or I can update my records. I can update my attribution my contribution to Adulka, and accordingly Adulka will give me the new attributions. Now coming to model, our second pillar, exactly it remains the same. So what we are saying that the model can be built by all of us, by the researcher, by the institute. And Adulka will make sure that the model listing stays at Adulka. Only the model listing. Now, once we do that, any enthusiast or researcher, they can search the models based upon the way they search data set. For example, let's say somebody is interested to search for let's say OCR model. They can come and search. They can use it. Okay, I want to look at OCR at let's say at Tamil script. Give me the model. So they can use the search filter and they can get various models. Now, what Adulka also does, it provides that. Okay, please note that the model still remains with the original publisher or the submitter. The model runs or the inference engine or model still runs with the submitter. What a submitter does, they will say that, okay, my model is available at this endpoint. So Adulka can make a callback toward the submitter's model for the inferencing, and the results can be displayed to the user. We call it as a try me functionality. So this way, anyone who's interested in, they can explore or experience, models or the output of model in real time, thus increasing the confidence of the model on the model submitter. So for that, what we also defined that, okay, the interface, how Adulka will make a callback toward model is also we have defined. Again, I would like, I'll stress upon this point, being an open source, we have made sure that the specification of callback APIs should remain, should be popularly acceptable by most by ourselves. I won't say like all of us, but let's say most of it should remain acceptable because they are very easy inferencing interface. So once submitted, the user or the submitter or the enthusiast can submit their model and Adulka does a very basic checks. Okay, the model endpoints are up or is not available. Based upon that, just to make sure that the model is available at the valid location, so that researcher or anybody who's interested in the model, they can come and look at the model. Finally, I'll take you to the benchmarking part. Benchmarking flow is very important. The reason we are saying that any data set that has been submitted out to Adulka, the 5% will be removed, will be parked toward validation. Now this 5% data will go through the human curation, thus making sure that this data remains at the highest of the quality. Obviously, the inference part of the data won't be released to anyone of the submitters. Making sure that the benchmarking is done in a very a fair way. For every benchmark for a given task, the popular metrics are already being supported. For example, let's say if you take MT, we have Blue, we have Meteor. For example, let's say if you take ASR, SER, or WER is already been supported. Now, let's say tomorrow research community comes up with a new benchmarking metric, Adulka can support that as well, provided all of us agree on that this should be the this should be the new metric that should be applied for let's say OCR kind of task. Now, all these things is supported by Adulka. The researcher or the research community with all consensus can define a metric, how the score should be calculated, that can be defined in Adulka. Adulka calculates Adulka using the benchmark data set, it will run on the submitted model, create the score, and then give it back to the submitter. Now, if you see, the submitter is totally submitter's choice to publish their model for the public usage. It's not ULCA's choice. Now, so what ULCA only provides is an ecosystem, or I would say as an environment where submitter can benchmark their models, can benchmark their output. If they are comfortable with their benchmark score, they can publish. And once published, then the model will be available for the public consumption. As we understand that for any modeling activity, benchmark has to be at the highest level. So the ULCA interface will make sure that the subject matter expert are engaged for every kind of data set, and they contribute creating, you know, help create a gold standard data for the evaluation purpose. And clearly, you know, if some model activities requires human intervention, so we can also support that one. So even after model score has been generated, the data set or the results can still be given to the human evaluator, the expert human evaluators. They can comment on that, you know, on the various, let's say, for example, in case of MT, ULCA can have a partner or human evaluators. They can comment upon, let's say, on adequacy or fluency score, even after MT score has been calculated. So all these results, you know, once submitter is satisfied, once submitter is okay with the output, the submitter can release it to public. And once published, then the model and the benchmark score will be presented for the other user who's looking for the model. Yep. So as we have said that, you know, the benchmark, the whole idea is to make sure that the benchmark is created, the gold standard data is created with a large volume for a different domain, capturing various diversity, thus, you know, enabling innovation and challenging people to contribute to ULCA. So the benchmark schema is also available at our Git repository. I would encourage everyone to have a look at it. Right now we have defined four benchmark interfaces for the translation, document layout, OCR, and the ASR. Clearly, we talked about this one. The benchmark result and the metric, can be defined for each type of activity.
Deepak, can you wrap up?
Yeah, just give me 2 minutes, I'll be done. So benchmark results and the benchmark metric, can be provided to the submitter. Submitter can, if submitter is okay, they can publish it. And once published, the result goes back to the leaderboard. Thus, available for all of us to look at. So I'm at the last slide. So that's all I wanted to present from the ULCA's perspective.
Great.
Yeah. So I'll stop here, and if anybody has any question, then I'll be happy to answer. I'll just stop sharing my screen. And thanks for the opportunity. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Deepak. I mean, it was a nice presentation. I believe that it is kind of a eye opener for the new project that we are going to come up with, the NLGM. And I believe that this is going to give a good, insight into the audience on what we are going to expect in the coming few years from the TDIL and the NLTM team. So, of course, we want some questions. So, I have got a few questions.
Yeah.
So, first of all, when Ritesh Kumar asks, how do you see ULCA versus GitHub?
Okay, so don't look ULCA as a let's say where we can do where the codes are residing. We are saying that no. Okay, the ULCA says that okay, there are the multiple repository, multiple data set contributed by various people. Based upon that, you can pull out the data set from ULCA, train your model, and host your model at your own infrastructure. Now, if a researcher, if a contributor or a startup wants to get a visibility, or let's say compare with already existing data set, models, the startup can actually compare their output and then If they are happy, they can submit their score or they can submit their model accuracy to come on the leaderboard. So that's one way of saying that okay, as a submitter or as a contributor on the mod, I can say that okay, my model is best model out there, making sure that enabling everyone to use it. So I would say that the model is hosted with Wellcome at this point of time. That's how we see it.
Yeah.
Model stays that. So that's the primary difference, I would say, from that perspective, GitHub versus Wellcome.
So Deepak, this is Vivek. I just want to add one more thing, that it is also, Wellcome is the place that various people, all the various open data sets that exist, it becomes a standardized way to put all of them into a single process. And so we would love to have as many data sets as possible. And we want to use various techniques to actually collect data sets. And we believe that for deep learning kind of approaches, we need to have very, very huge data, and everybody's data needs to come together. And this is basically the place where both the data and the models will actually come together. And that is how this is envisioned. And and in the context, open source being the one of the key principles, this is going to be open data sets in Indian languages. Collected using various methods and being all available in a single place and searchable and discoverable by anybody. And so both data sets and models with full attribution. So it is not saying that the data set has to be created here. The data set is just hosted here with full attribution, but all open data sets are available to everybody who wants to do something with it.
Right.
Great. I mean, I still have some more questions, and of course, some users also have a question, but I believe that we can take it up over email. Is it all right, sir, Vivek and Deepak, suppose if I send these questions
Absolutely. To
you and the speakers, the questions who have been asked, so maybe we can take this discussion forward later over email.
Absolutely, absolutely. And we would love to actually work with the CIL and see how we can collaborate in some of these things that we are doing. So definitely, we would be very happy to answer the questions.
Great. Thank you. So we will go with the thank you. I mean, both Deepak and Vivek. Of course, Vijayji. I think Vijayji might have left. I know there is a PhD meeting going on there. So thank you for giving a very good idea on Wellcome and what we should expect both in the new project that is coming up, and I believe that it is also going to be at the back end of the NPL, the new data portal that TDIL is going to release in place of TDIL.ac.in. So thank you. We'll move to the next speaker, Sonali.
Yes, sir.
Thank you again.
The second lecture is on the topic of big linguistic data and the Indian Grand Challenge by Professor Krishna Jha, Dean, School of Sanskrit and Indic Studies, Jawaharlal Nehru University. Professor Krishna Jha is the Professor of Linguistics and Computational Linguistics at the School of Indic Studies and Adjunct Faculty of Linguistics at Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. He is a pioneer of NLP in India and someone who has oriented scores of linguists to take up NLP as a career path. He also has 2 decades of experience working with almost all the government agencies in India promoting language technology. He has also been consulting several industrial entities on various types of problems relating to language technology. Professor Jha played a pivotal role in creating the largest parallel corpora in Indian languages through a project funded by the TDIL program of the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. I welcome you, sir, for your lecture.
Thank you. Thank you, Sonali. My gratitude to CIL, the director, and the assistant director for inviting me to this very prestigious seminar, and I congratulate CIL for persistently working on a very tedious task, which is getting data for Indian languages out in the public domain. And what a nice opportunity. I'm following the TDIL team, which gave a nice presentation on Wellcome. I guess a couple of weeks ago, I had heard about it from TDIL, and I was going to talk to you on getting our data kind of curated and uploaded to Ulka and maybe put it in the open source. And I think it's a nice platform, and perhaps the whole approach now is going to solve the problem that Indian language technology has been suffering from over the years. So I really congratulate you, the entire team, Vivek, Deepak, Vijayji, and others for putting this up together. Thank you so much. Let me quickly go to my presentation. So today I'm going to very briefly talk about the big linguistic data and the bigger linguistic data from the Indian situation. And it gets more and more complex and more challenging. There are a lot many challenges in India, actually, not really the actual challenge of collecting and getting data annotated, curated, stored, and shared, but also the bottlenecks that we as an India, you know, we present to ourselves. In India, data becomes bigger, and there are issues of on the capture, storage, annotation, visualization, analysis, decision making, all that gets more and more complex. You know, even capturing, for example, capturing from physical media. And take the example of the FIR being registered in the village police station. That might be in a regional variety of an Indian language. And then when that gets to the court, it becomes a standard regional variety of that region. And then when it goes to a higher court, it might become English, you know. So things are really, really different and idiosyncratic in India. The data gets huge, variable, and it is being created on the fly. A lot of data gets created on mobile phone. And that perhaps would be the biggest data which is coming through mobile phone. If you know how to capture it nicely, will be. The other day I was talking to some teams, and they said, why not Maghi? Why not Bhojpuri? Why not Chhattisgarhi has data? I said, there's a lot of people speaking the language, but we should know how to capture that data. But there's very little, you know, public domain data on the internet, newspapers, printed material. We have to depend on people to get the data transferred to electronic format. So these are very complex data sets. To handle them, to capture them, we need very smart algorithms. And I'm very happy to see this Ulka is one such algorithm, and it should be tested on diverse data sets which is coming from different corners of India. And database techniques are also constantly evolving, the earlier times when we would simply try to map a natural language data to SQL through certain parsing and generating algorithm to get results from database is gone. Now we basically do a simple structured text files, JSON, etc., and we can directly query databases. So things are becoming easier, but the data itself is becoming very, very complex and diverse. Now the complexity of linguistic data, obviously we need smarter and robust algorithms and technologies. And there's a lot of new requirements on pre-processing. I was talking to some of my students the other day. The data is very complex. They're merged. The words are not separate. For example, the data from, say, Garhwali, if you look at the data from Garhwali, it wouldn't be space. It would be words merged together. And if you want to normalize that, you have to have a lot of smart processes. Pre-processing is a big task. Now, even, for example, the Garhwali, you would have the retroflex L, that you found in Vedic and in Tamil. And when you kind of convert that to ITRANS, you don't know, ITRANS doesn't have any equivalent for retroflex L. So now, someone reported to me yesterday that my converter is not taking care of the retroflex L, which is found in Garhwali body data. So now I have to go and maybe make room for it. So a lot of new situations are presented when you diversify, go into the field and look at the real data which the people speak out there. And the multilinguality is a big problem. And sometimes you have the multi-script, you have more than one script in the data set. and the mixed languages. And you might have heard about mixed scripting. You know, there are a lot of Sanskrit manuscripts where the data begins in one script and suddenly you have another script coming in, and suddenly two scripts get merged. For example, you know, you may have in Devanagari, you have the E matra coming from the left, and if you will see the Bangla, there's a Prishna matra is represented in a different way. So there's one Mahabharata manuscript rewritten in Devanagari in the Bengal region, and the Bengali person tried unconsciously put in his Bengali knowledge into the Devanagari. So we get influenced and mixed scripts. So a lot of these complexities are there, actually, if you look at the real data from India. So we have to have a very smart, database techniques. So conventional DB language may have to be interfaced with a natural mixed language. You know, when I did a thesis in UI, I used English, command English for SQL. Here you have to use mixed Indian language, and most of the Indian languages today use are mixed language. Then you have to bootstrap crawlers with voice commands, and crawlers like, for example, I will show you. I have one crawler running right now, collecting Bhojpuri and data and creating Bhojpuri data. So these crawlers have to be bootstrapped, you know, with actual voice commands, and through SQLNL mode, and obtain data, store them in DB on the fly. You know, DB, when I say DB, I do not necessarily mean RDBMS. I can mean any more convenient platforms, you know, convenient methodologies. And of course, you have to crawl comparable data. We may not always find parallel data, you know. Comparable data is a lot of data there, Wikipedia, for example. And we can obtain the necessary data that we want to obtain, and then train our ML algorithms. Now, some examples of the big linguistic data from India. There are more, actually. I'm only putting some judicial documents, huge amount of judicial data. I'll talk about that a little later. And the administration papers, historical records, sale purchase records, you know, newspapers and print media. Other day, I was looking at the newspapers in India. I think about 60 languages have newspapers in India, and not all languages have newspapers. But this data is voluminous. Literatures are there, written, oral, and active literatures, and film and television, Facebook, other social media. And of course, a big chunk is a Sanskrit Pali Prakrit manuscripts, which is languishing in big numbers, and we are losing hundreds of them every week. And then, you know, other language historical texts also. Multilingualism and complexity is the hallmark of the Indian linguistic ecosystem. We have 22 official languages, and when we talk about language technology, we always go to the more commercial and attractive languages. Industry does so, and government funding also perhaps does so. CIL is an exception. It does most of the languages. The Bharatvani is doing 100 languages, but the most of the other government projects will go for the major languages, not the minor languages. Industry does major languages, government projects do major languages, and they basically do overlap and you know, basically reinventing the wheel over and over again. And we have 37 more languages which are not scheduled languages but major languages, and they are being added to our constitution, and there'll be, you know, you can imagine 59 so languages, and 1700 plus minor languages and varieties. For example, Garhwali is not even a scheduled language of India, but Garhwali itself has 12 dialects. And one dialect is a very, very interesting language, Bangani, which is related to Indo-European history. So even the dialects, you know, that we consider, you know, not major languages, they have not many dialects. And English is not being looked at with more interest, because English is the second most spoken language in India after Hindi. And we should better consider it an Indian language and look at, you know, tools for Indian English also. So multilingual media, movies, TV, print education, all of that is presenting a lot of complexity. And to make things worse, the language policy has now of late has been looked at more seriously, I guess. And Professor Kapil Kapoor came up with a good comprehensive language policy. Education policy is now turning a new leaf. And I'm very hopeful with this and a very bold policy that has come, that has been put forward with the government, from the government. Now, governance, health, everything you talk about, there's a lot of data waiting out there, and we need to know how to capture that. So multilinguality, language and script mixing, English as an essential mix in all the Englishes, all of that brings presents a lot of complexity. Look at the internet presence of Indian languages. English, of course, 53%, more than 53%. A lot of this contribution comes from India also. India is a major English-speaking country, and it contributes a lot of English data on the internet. But Hindi, the biggest language from India, is not even 0.1% on internet. That looks at that brings to our notice the disparity, huge disparity that we have. But the good thing is that the more recently, 9 out of 10 new internet users are actually demanding and using Indian languages. And our language requirements are far more diverse and far more complex than you would find even the entire Europe, which is 25 languages put together. And English is a big problem, and I call it world Englishes. I remember I did a course with Professor Brush Kacharu in UI, and that was world Englishes. Now I kind of try to copy that, call it world Englishes, because we mix English in India and all Indian languages. And the diasporic populations, Indian populations, when they go abroad, they not only mix English in Indian languages they carry to their new lands, but also bring in the languages from those lands. So it's a very, very complex phenomenon. And there are socio-psychological motives and reasons for code and mixing and code switching. English can be mixed, switched with any of our languages, and mixing happens at any level. For example, you can hear Bollywood sounds crazy, kiya re, confused kiya, and all that. And in Bangla, you have crazy kora, confused kora. And NLP tools have to cater to such phenomena. And of course, the speech tools have to be more resistant. I'm currently working with Google to study some of the varieties in this perspective. Now, modern complexity mixed with non-standard multimodal communications also. Now, when people move in India from one place to other, their gesturing also gets affected. And mixed with non-standard speech data, non-standard text data, and social media usages, handwritten texts and manuscripts are very, very complex, as I mentioned earlier, and they're mixed and influenced scripts. And examples of dead scripts which are being revived. For example, Sharada is being revived now at JNU, and there are a lot of documents in Sharada scripts which have to be actually taken care of. Now, to create robust NL applications, we need critical language technology resource, of course, because, it's again, hence story, basically, because whether you will first create data, then create robust tools, and then create more data, or you create robust tools first and then create data, because we cannot always depend on the manpower. Now, these are the critical areas. You already know all of that. I'm going to skip very quickly. Now, there are requirements for resource creation in complex linguistic societies like India, and I'll basically focus on that now. So data has to be available. Data, if you know, the speech data is available. Mobile phone is the biggest carrier of speech data, but the electronic data is hard to get actually in India. And as you saw from various presentations, the issues and challenges. The standards are, of course, very difficult to get in India. I'll talk about that, because we are a very diverse country. We don't always follow government rules. We follow gods if we don't follow government rules and procedures. And manpower, of course, is a lot of manpower, but you have to train them into quality manpower. A lot of tools are needed, because we cannot always create data always, manually. We have to bootstrap the process and use automatic processes to create data in collection, creation, annotation, management, et cetera, and of course, funding is a big, big issue. And some of these presentations you saw earlier were talking about funding, and that's the oxygen that we always need. And which is not the case in European Union, actually. I've been visiting many of these countries. I've been participating in their efforts. The Saarbrücken Center of German AI, where I gave a talk in 2014 or 15, they told me that they have 6 billion euro as the budget for that center alone, yearly budget. Can we match that budget in India? That's a big question. So obviously we have to make sure the industry, academia, government, all of them, they come together and don't replicate each other's work. Then only we can perhaps match that. So availability of data, we have to look at major as well as minor languages. Many of the minor languages that we think they are minor, they're actually major languages in their areas. Garhwali is one of them. And they're resource poor and endangered languages. A lot of languages of the Northeast are heavily endangered. And they're also shared languages. A lot of languages in Northeast are shared with Bangladesh. A lot of languages of the Bihar and Uttar Pradesh are shared with Nepal. lot of languages are shared with Pakistan, you know, and Sri Lanka. So we need to also make sure the efforts, for example, for Nepali that we do in India is not duplicated in Nepal. Efforts for Bangla that we do in India are not duplicated in Bangladesh. I was giving a speech in one of the seminars in Sylhet, Bangladesh. There's a lot of effort being made there for Bangla there, and I'm sure there's a lot of overlaps with what we do in India. A lot of efforts for Urdu similarly in India, and in Urdu for doing in Pakistan. We have to make sure that things are not overwritten and then overdone and overlapped. And the oral tradition is the hallmark of the entire South Asian subcontinent, and script and writing standards are not always standardized. And we have a lot of analog data, as I said, pre-digital, born digital data, and there'll be obviously copyright issues, idiosyncratic copyright issues, and I'll tell you how I bypass that. And I'm crawling data actually. Data creation, storage, annotation, sharing standards have to be created, and some data sources and possible data sources. I have I'm going to show you what could be some possible data sources. For example, newspapers, let's look at 17 languages in India have newspapers. 12 major languages, Hindi, Bangla, Urdu, Kannada, Malayalam, Tamil, Telugu, Gujarati, Assamese, Punjabi, Marathi, Odia. English, of course, is major language, and 4 minor languages. Sanskrit is just one newspaper. Kashmiri has 2 or 3 that perhaps only online. Manipuri and Mizo have one newspaper. Not all of them are available online to collect data.
Sir, ye hide button pe click kar dijiye, wo bhag jayega.
Okay, thank you. Oh, I thought you're not seeing that. Okay. Online material, there's a lot of online material, newspapers, Wikipedia, Facebook, etc., and Government of India sites, media sites. Printed text, not all of them. I was just discussing with some group yesterday, where are the printed texts so that we can use OCR to convert them. And not all of them have, not many languages. For example, Chhattisgarhi is a big language of Chhattisgarh, is not perhaps a medium of instruction in Chhattisgarh. So where do you get textbooks, right? That's a big question. And Bhojpuri, similarly Maghi, Garhwali, for example, you won't get that as textbooks, you won't get that. Sahitya Academy has 22 scheduled languages. There are a lot of literature available. And plus Rajasthani, which is not a scheduled language, and English is an associate official language. So for 24 languages in Sahitya Academy. A lot of video channels, Doordarshan, TV, regional channels, films, police station records, government offices, courts, I'll talk about that separately, and recordings of village and community events. All of that can lead to a lot of data, but we need to know how to capture it actually, and how to capture it actually by getting people on board, you know, and we cannot just leave people out there. And then each data will have a lot of domains, not easy actually. Each data can have 18 domains. And when, you know, Narayanji was working in our project in JNU, he created nicely all these domain and subdomain. You can see all the 18 domains that we collect data from, and each domain can have a lot of subdomains. I'll mention the agriculture subdomains, and also later on mention the law and legal subdomain. Standards have to be created, and in India, as I said, the standards nobody likes. Parni's grammar was the only standards that everybody followed. 7th century BCE grammar still is followed for documenting Sanskrit, and of course the grammars of some other Indian languages also. And Government of India did a lot of efforts earlier. ISKI is well known, and then POS standards led by Microsoft Research Institute, and later on by Bureau of Indian Standards. And manpower, of course, will be the most difficult aspect to actually solve. And crowd is a good model. And now I think the DIT, MIT, is actually looking at more seriously this model. And I'm sure this is a very, very good step in the right time. And we also should look at limited crowd model. Our platform is limited crowd model. Using startup companies, using academic institutions, because there are a lot of students who can contribute data easily and cheaply. And data organizations and Section 8 company could be looked at. I remember participating in a discussion at the NITI IO, because I have been dealing very closely with the LDC, UPenn, and also I was the consultant, and ELRA, of course, and something similar could have perhaps been thought of in India. And the tools, a lot of data collection tools, data creation through bootstrapping, I don't want to talk about the details of how we did that. Annotation and sanity check, copyright, plagiarism check, etc. Management, data export, import, and visualization. All of that has to be created. So I'm looking at a platform which puts in all of this together, you know, including the copyright, etc., all those things. Funding, the most important aspect. We have 22 scheduled languages, 37 plus English, and 37 more coming. So India, of course, is overburdened with a lot of caring to be done for Indian languages. And our constitution being very liberal on languages, so we have to be really, really careful in not actually ignoring any of the languages of India. And so the government of India is putting its best effort, and then industry and a lot of these altruistic organizations and language and community groups, these are funding. So how do you resolve funding issues where we can have contributions from stakeholders, as could be thought LDC does it, and model of LRA LDC could be followed. Membership fees could be put in, data company can be created, a Section 8 company can be modeled and created. Revenue generation as CIL is doing, and of course TDIL, we created a good document. Naranji, of course, was the leading person creating that document. Now the CDIAC is going to perhaps host that data after all the stakeholders signed the agreement. Data sharing is very, very critical, and I'm sure Ulka is turning a new leaf around here. I'm sure that's going to be very, very successful. And why are people not sharing? Because the cost is involved, of course, and data may have been the basis for the proprietary software, and of course, the bread and butter earner. How to go about it? Cost could be handled by bargaining some matching data in return, and also the benefits of customizations, improvements, etc., can be done. If data is linked to the software, they can release it after a certain period when their software has progressed to the next level. So all these things can be considered, the concerns of the data creators. Data sharing models, of course, GitHub is there now. Ulka is a similar platform. We can perhaps look at it, perhaps more useful and more detailed in the Indian language context. We must ensure the seamless flow of data across, like TIPRA platform of the Norwegian University, and there is a platform the Florence University, and there is our platform ILCI, and all these platforms. We can look at the data exchange, routines to be followed. For example, TIPRA does another higher level of annotation. So maybe the data from ILCI with the two layers of annotation can flow in there. They can add more layers of annotation and bring it back to us. So all these things have to be done, and we should have a global actually consortium for doing that. I'm already actually working with, there's a University of Flores data platform where we create data for robotics training, teaching actions to robots. So the all these things have to be done slowly. And a consortium of stakeholders with commonly agreed MOU, I'm going to skip that, because and then some examples of the legal domain. So these are subdomains of the law, because this is the most complex data they can get in legal domain, because we need that more often in everyday life, and there's a lot of pendency in courts, Supreme Court, 25 high courts, and 672 district courts. And you can see the 3.5 crore plus cases pending, 30,000 files every day, and only 28,000 heard, 2,000 ads on. There's a lot of these issues in our judiciary. And how to solve? We have to solve it by bringing in a lot of technology. A lot of AI has to be brought in from the bottom level, where we capture data from the police stations and all the way up to Supreme Court. We have to basically be able to capture that data. Now, the smart tools that we need to build to capture, all these data acquisition, translation, cross-lingual access, summarization, etc. All those smart technologies need a lot of annotated data. And creating new data, of course, involves a lot of effort. And then translating data involves a lot of effort. And we had created a translation guideline. I think Naranji played a critical role in creating this translation guideline in our project, Naranji and Hsieh Banerjee. And then we annotate data. And for annotation, we have to find proper guidelines, standards, and I know you perhaps all you know about it, the levels of annotation. I'm not going to show that, we do not have time. And the and then see the standards of annotation that we followed with the our part of speech standards for Indian languages, and the chunking standards we took from IIIT, Deepti's standards. And then we created a lot of such data. I'm not going to show that here, lack of time. But despite bottlenecks, there have been good news recently in Indian language data creation, as you might have, may have gone through the recent presentations. So NLTM Ulka is a bright spot. You just heard about it. NLPLT, National Platform for Language Technology, Vijay just talked about that. LDCIL, Bharatmani, I'm associated with both of these projects, and they are fantastic work. And I'm sure this model is going to catch more attention in the diverse India that we have. Mori recently was released by the Google India team, and it's fantastic. I was more happy when they told me that they have included Sanskrit also in it. I'm looking at that, you know, for doing some nuanced task for Hindi currently. XTIF Foundation, Samananta's 46.9 million parallel corpora, and I'll be I'm looking at that data. I'll be more keen into looking the parallel corpora that they have, and AI for Bharat IndiCorp. I keep on getting these emails, and they're doing fantastic work. Most of these colleagues I know them, you know. And IIT Chennai recently released 650 hours of ASR data. Thank you, Umeshji, for bringing that to light. And I'm thinking, you know, if the TDL allows me, I can also release entire ILCI data in public domain. ISAC Kolkata informed me that they have released 0.5 million Indian English sentences, and they need to know how to actually. So I'll tell them that you contact ULCA, and if they can maybe partner with ULCA in getting that into a proper format and an API mode. And Genie LCI, you know, manually created, translated, and annotated the POS chunk. Total 1.7 million parallel sentences in 17 Indian languages, including English. So I'll quickly talk about this project. It was funded by MIPI and the biggest consortia of 17 institutes headed by JNU. And we finished in 2017, created this 1.7 million sentences of parallel data annotated at parse and chunk levels. And we created a server actually. So I have a server in my school in JNU, and I manage that personally. And so these tools have all these facilities, and I'm going to talk about particularly the besides the translation facility, annotation facility, data export into XML and CSV tab formats, and we are going to include JSON very soon, and import from, you know, formats if they are formatted as by LCI format, we can upload data from our upload tool. And this is our server. This is a 5-server, you know, put together. Parni, Patanjali, Katyan, Bhartri, Nagesh Bhatt, all these 5 servers are working in tandem. And so this can be scaled to any larger group, you know, give you a lot of space, a lot of processing power. And so I'll quickly show you the interface very quickly here on my server. So if you just log in, I'm logging in as admin and logging in the master user. I'll really quickly show you, just take a minute, show you the ILCI platform. So logged in as a so we can obviously corpora status. So I'll show you the progress graph. Let me, I think I logged in as an admin. So let me log in as master user and admin. And okay, so you can see all these language data here we have, and then you can do all the command management, and there are a lot of visualization is here. I want to show you the details here. Let me go to some particular language here. I want to show you admin and any Bangla data very quickly, and add edit corpora. You can create monolingual corpora here, and so if you know, for example, you create monolingual corpora, and you can select a particular subdomain, say for example any subdomain from that domain, and then you can then select some data source, and it comes with all the metadata. So all that is possible here, and then I can so the annotation part here, if you I will take you to the master phase two of the and then so I can show you the progress graph of the project and all that, you know, and there's a whole management, basically a series of, you know, and vetting, etc., all that, uploading data and exporting data, all of that is possible. So there's XML convert, you convert data to XML, all that is here. So I can perhaps, you know, take you to the our chunking platform. All that is chunking, and part of speech platform is there, a translation platform is there built in this whole thing. So for lack of time, I'm not going to show that management. Of course, I can show you here. So now there are a lot of other resources that we have created besides ILCA through consultancies. I'm currently consulting with Google in creating some data set for the varieties of the Eastern varieties of Hindi, so that we can report on how these systems can be made more robust in handling search and translation better. And for Nuance, the Kashmiri dataset was created, and for SwiftKey, when it was not Microsoft, we created datasets for these languages for making predictive keyboards. And then online handwriting datasets were created for Microsoft for the tablet PC in 2006, and multimodal eight language datasets for security purposes for these eight languages with LDC University of Pennsylvania. And then English to Urdu machine translation system on Bing. You can see the tool here, and you see English to Urdu. You can see created by JNU. You can test that tool. And on the same lines, we are currently working out of my own personal research interest, English Maithili, Sanskrit English Maithili is in good shape. Sanskrit Hindi, English Gujarati, English Sindhi, Sanskrit English. These are in various levels of development. This one is in good stage. This is also. So thank you so much for giving time to me. And I hope this broad perspective and view on the Indian language data scenario is going to yield good results. And I'm hopeful that with the XDEF Foundation and the coming of the startup companies and the young bright guys into this field will really turn a good leaf, a new leaf in the whole process. And I'm sure TDIL's whole initiatives will be bearing desired fruit. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. It was a big overview of the language scenario and the data scenario in Indian languages. And I believe that the kind of work that you are doing at JNU is something that some of these parts can be emulated at LDCL also. So I'm not sure if you would be willing to contribute something towards the technology parts. Let's say, for example, we want to collect more data for all the other Indian languages. So maybe we can do some kind of a collaboration where when you crawl the data and then share with us, we do the proofreading and other things, and then finally make it part of the raw text corpus that we have already released. So if you can think in that direction and give us something, maybe we can go ahead with that.
Absolutely. I'm waiting for a go ahead from TDIL. If they tell me yes, go, why not? I'd be more than happy to do it.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Anyone has any questions? I don't see any questions. So I'll thank you, sir. And we will move towards the next speaker. And also, we will extend the time by 20 minutes so that Monojit should not feel bad that he is not getting enough time. We'll extend the whole of this proceedings by 20 minutes. So Sonali, please.
Yes, sir. Yes. The third lecture will be on massively multilingual neural language models, the new hope as well as fear for the low resources languages by Dr. Monojit Chaudhary, Microsoft Research India. He has been a researcher in Microsoft Research Lab, India since 2007. His research interests cut across the areas of linguistics, cognition, and computation. Currently, he is working on script and code mixing, especially in social media and web search. They have introduced the notion of mixed script information retrieval. He also works on various NLP and information retrieval techniques for Indian languages. In the past, he has worked on computational musicology, language evolution, evolution of the structure of web search queries and complex networks. I'm happy to welcome Dr. Manoji Choudhury for his lecture.
Good morning, everybody. I think, yeah, it's still good morning. And thank you so much for inviting me to give this talk, and especially on this very important occasion of releasing the data sets. In fact, I think, you know, 10 years, 20 years from now, these will be the historic moments which historians of technology will write about, like how the technologies in various Indian languages have over the years grown, and these are because of these data sets that they have grown. And also, you know, the three talks before me so nicely, I mean, I'm including Narayan's introduction to the data set that was being released, as well as Girish's and about Ulka. So they all talked about beautifully how we are all working on creating so many data sets in Indian languages. So my talk is coming more from the technology side of things, which is that as I talk now, and we all are discussing data sets and technology, there's a revolution happening in NLP. And this revolution, which has started around 2019, has changed the way how we do multilingual models, or how we in general build models in natural language processing. And it has very strong repercussions on data sets, and you know, which languages in what kind of data sets, how much data sets, which languages in turn will win the race, and who are at a great danger. Knowing these things are very important so that we can accordingly channelize our efforts in what kind of data sets to create and to what extent and so on. So this is the perspective of the talk. So this is something we all know probably here, that how NLP has progressed over the years is from a more rule-driven research area, it has become more data-driven. It's no different in, let's say, the field of computer vision or artificial intelligence in general. So in 1990s, the data sets became important in the field of NLP, and more systems were empirical and data-driven. And in 2000s, with the big data revolution, the NLP data sets also became very large. What's happened in 2010 is with deep learning, we can now do even better things, and therefore we can do, you know, we need even bigger data sets for doing those better things. 2020 is what happened, is what I'm going to talk in the rest of the lecture. So let's hold on for a moment. But there is one interesting law that I want to share with you before we proceed. So this law is that of, you know, model size, amount of data required, and the accuracy of the model. So this graph, by the way, is a chronological way of showing how these neural models have been increasing only in this last 2 years, 2018 to 2020. And this is in, you know, the sizes are I'm talking about are in billions of parameters. And you might have heard about the name GPT-3, which is a neural model for English language generation. And you see how tremendously, it's a doubly exponential growth of these model sizes. Now, as you can imagine, as the models, as we need to train bigger models, we need more data. So, you know, the data sizes also have to grow exponentially. Fortunately, for some languages like English, we have that much data, so we can build these kind of models. But what is also interesting is that these models are more accurate. They're achieving accuracies that we couldn't think of before. So it's like, big data or more data implies bigger models, implies better models. So this is the central dogma of natural language processing or language technologies today. So we have to bear that in mind as we proceed through you know, this talk. So what happened in 2020, or rather a little before, so 2019, there is this new idea came up, this new technology came up, which is called massively multilingual zero-shot learning. Let me try to explain you in a very, you know, high level. If you are interested in knowing the technical nitty-gritties, many of you are already aware of, I'm sure. Others who don't know and want to know, maybe I can refer you to some material at the end of the talk or later over email. But for the purpose of this talk, what suffices to know is this. So typically when we train a natural language processing model, let's say for sentiment classification in Hindi, we would need data which is annotated with sentiment labels. So let's say I have a bunch of tweets and in Hindi, and these tweets are marked with whether it's a positive sentiment or negative sentiment or neutral sentiment. Similarly, for training a post tagger model, I would need post tagged data. So this is what we typically mean when we talk about annotated or labeled linguistic data. And they are required in large volumes when we want to build bigger and better models. However, and since we want to build models for all these languages that we have been talking about, let's say as many Indian languages as we want to, we need data for all these languages. Now, this becomes almost an unsolvable task, especially in a context like India, because, well, we have 22 scheduled languages, but the actual number of languages spoken is very large. And Girish so nicely, you know, pointed out that even if we call everything as Hindi or English, they are not the same language. There are so many versions of Hindi. So how do you go and keep collecting that much data? So this was a big challenge. And nobody knew how to solve it other than collecting data. So what happened in 2019 is we came up with this idea of massively multilingual pre-trained model, which I put as the blue box here. It's also called the universal language model. Why universal? Because you just train this model with unlabeled data, just text corpora, nothing else. So you take a English, let's say you take the Wikipedia, corpus of English, Hindi, French, Swahili, Kannada, Japanese, all languages that exist in Wikipedia, and train a model. The training process I'm not getting into, but train a model. So you need no label data. Now, this model cannot do much. It can only generate these languages again. So it's like a language model. However, suppose now you want to solve for sentiment analysis. What you do is you put a new model in front of it, let's say a few layers of neurons, and then train it with a little bit of labeled sentiment data only in one language. So typically we call this the pivot language, and let's say we trained it for English. So this process is called fine tuning. So the first process is called pre-training, because you are training ahead of time before you are actually building a real model. A task-specific model. And this task-specific training is called fine-tuning. These terms are important because we'll refer to these. So pre-training and fine-tuning. And once you start fine-tuning only on English data, it should work for English. That's not a surprise. But magically, this entire model starts working for all the languages. So essentially, you have been able to transfer the information from English to all the other languages, which the model has seen no label data in. There was no label data for Hindi. It was only an unlabeled data, no label data for Kannada. So it actually is extremely promising, as you can imagine. It just, makes it totally unnecessary to create label data across a large number of languages. You can create it for some languages, and in fact, it already exists in many languages. And therefore, you are done. You just need unlabeled data. So this is what is the promise of this massively multilingual zero-shot learning. And, these models have revolutionized with this promise, they have been growing very fast. So a lot of people are putting a lot of effort in it. First model came in 2019 with 100 languages, including 11 Indian languages in the original pre-trained model. So this was called Multilingual BERT. Then we have a slightly better version of this model, which is called XLM Roberta, but same statistics in terms of number of languages. Then came more specific, language-specific models. So there was Indic BERT, which had 12 Indian languages, and it did a little better than these generic models because they were trained specifically with Indian languages. And then more recently, we have Mural from Google, which again, Girish also referred to. So this has 17 languages, 17 Indian languages on which it is trained on. So, and research is going on. I know AI for Bharat is training one such model, which will be coming out soon, and so on and so forth. All companies, Google, Microsoft, Facebook, everybody has their model, and it's a race of whose model is better. So, which is all the good for, us, the technologists, because now we can have technology for languages that we speak. But there are certain things to note here. What are the things? So let's look at the scale. So what kind of data we require to train such a model? First is we need unlabeled data, the text corpus I talked about for pre-training. And that has to be typically in millions to trillions of words. The bigger, the better. the central dogma of NLP, right? Bigger the better. So million, when it just starts working, billion is better, trillion will be excellent. Label data, we need for only a few languages called the pivot languages for fine tuning. And typically we need 10,000 to a million labeled instances. So it will be sentences if sentiment, it will be like, you know, tokens if it is post-tagged and so on. But again, bigger the better. At least for some languages, you need a lot of, you know, label data in the order of millions. Others, you know, you might have less and some even zero. That's the benefit of this zero-shot learning, right? You need zero label data in many languages. But even though you need zero label data for fine-tuning, you need at least some label data for testing. I have built a model and I have tested it on, I mean, I have trained it on 100 languages, including 11 Indian languages, but tested it on only two Indian languages, let's say Hindi and Urdu, which are also very similar languages. And I haven't done anything on any of the other, let's say, nine languages. How do I know even it works, right? But to test for my technology, let's say sentiment analysis, I need at least test data. So test data is required for all languages. And it's of the order of, I mean, for a good, you know, estimate of your model, you get need at least 10,000 instances. But you can start with very small, maybe even 100 language instances would give you some estimate. So this is the backstage story of how much data you need for these models to work. So with that, let's try to answer three questions in this talk. The first question is, which languages are benefited through this technology? Second is, which languages are hurt in the process? And as we shall see, a lot of languages are in fact hurt by this process. And third is, what should we do? You know, knowing that some languages are hurt, all languages are not benefited, and so on. So to understand which languages are benefited, we recently, last year, did an analysis of how much data is available in various languages around the world. Not only Indian languages, but around the world. Now, there are two kinds of data which are important. I already said, unlabeled data and labeled data. So the unlabeled data is plotted on x-axis, and the labeled data is plotted on y-axis. And each dot represents a language. So I'm not getting into the detail of how exactly those data was collected. You can go through the paper, but that's not important. The picture nevertheless remains the same, that, you know, the world's languages can be neatly divided into these six classes, from class zero to class five. So class five are the languages which has the most amount of resources. This is the language, this dot, as you can see here, which has the highest number of resources, both unlabeled and labeled. So no prize guessing which language, right? This is English. But there are a few other languages in this set. Then there are these languages four, three, and so on. But if you come to this part, right? Language in class one, they have little bit of unlabeled data, almost no labeled data. Class two also is similar, very little labeled and unlabeled data. And class zero has nothing. Now, one thing to note again is the scales are logarithmic. So, you know, from here to here, it's four or five orders of magnitude difference. So like 10,000 times more resources. Class one has 10,000 times more resources than class zero. And class two has 100 times more resources than class one, and so on and so forth. Class five has almost a crore, 10 to the power seven times more resources than class zero. So this is actually a logarithmic scale. So the, you know, skew is very, very, deep or strong, right? Okay. So the technology that I told you is the one which helps the language which has a lot of unlabeled data to pre-train. You don't need a lot of labeled data to fine-tune, but at least some labeled data to test. Turns out that it's only the class three languages which are benefited. Class five and four already have enough data to build monolingual models. You don't need to do all these things. Class zero has no unlabeled data. You can't build anything for them anyway, so they are left out. Class one also has so little unlabeled data that you can't do much. And even if you do something, you can't test because there is no labeled data to test them on, right? So zero and one, you can't do anything. Two, you can try, but mostly unsuccessful because the amount of unlabeled data is again very little. So it's the language three, languages in class three which are benefited. So we in our paper call them the rising stars. These were the left outs, and so on. I forgot the name of the all the classes, but these we call the rising stars precisely for this reason. And fortunately, I mean, there are 28 languages here with 1.8 billion speakers. So this is a good news, I would say, overall. But let's look at the statistics a little more closely. So this shows examples of languages in these various classes, number of languages in each class, number of speakers they cover, and percentage of languages. Turns out that 88% of the world's languages, which is spoken by 1.2 billion people, are untouched by any of these benefits of technology. They are in class zero. So none of these are going to help them. Whereas five has only seven languages, and none of the Indian languages feature here actually. And and various things in between. Now, if I look at the Indian language scenario, so Hindi is in class four. In fact, Hindi has enough resources to even build monolingual models. We have been doing that for this, deep revolution happened. So Hindi is good to go. Bengali, Tamil, and Urdu are the rising stars. They have the amount of resources that the zero shot can really help. Konkani, Marathi, Punjabi, Sanskrit are catching up. So I'm hopeful for them too. They are in class two. But these languages, right, and which is a large chunk of languages, all the scheduled languages I have noted, Telugu, Gujarati, Kannada, Odia, and so on, have very little resources so far to get substantial benefit. They don't have enough unlabeled data actually to substantially benefit from the technology. And then rest of the Indian languages, right? Think of all other Indian languages, they fall in class zero. And it's not surprising to most of you here, and people who are working with resources, they I'm sure know this already. So this is the Indian language scenarios. Look, the inverted pyramid shape, right? I mean, it just naturally became like an inverted pyramid. And that's how the laws of economics work. Rich gets richer and all those. Yeah, but thing to note is they have a very large number of speaker groups, all these languages together. So let's come to the next question now, that which languages are hurt in the process? So I till now said which languages are left out, right? But they are not necessarily being directly hurt. So there are also some languages which get directly hurt by this kind of technology. So this is a graph which shows, each of these is a task. This is a natural language inferencing task. This is a part of speech tagging task, NER task, and so on. In this axis is the accuracy plotted, and higher the better. And here you see languages actually classified in terms of their family, roughly family. So Dravidian is there, Indo-Aryan is there, Roman, Slavic, Germanic, and so on. And what these people showed is when you try to do zero-shot transfer between languages, the actual accuracy you see varies a lot across languages. So for instance, for post tagging, right? Languages which are in the Sino-Tibetan family are not benefited at all if you are training. So here, by the way, here in all these cases, I assume that the training, the label data is coming only from English. The pivot is English. So if with English as a pivot, you have a very asymmetric and unequal advantage to various languages. And why? Linguists already know this. This is because of language typology and language family. So each language has a different word order, different, other kind of syntactic features, and therefore, and also vocabulary overlap, lexicon overlap is different. So a language like English really helps German when you do cross-lingual transfer, but it really doesn't help Hindi much or Japanese much. So to help Hindi, you do need some data from Hindi. And if you put some data from Hindi, it will start automatically helping, let's say, Marathi, Bangla to a good extent. So these things have to be borne in mind when we are trying to paint the big picture, that all zero shot doesn't work equally well. We have to be mindful of which languages we choose as pivot languages. And I will give you an interesting example that I personally faced in my research. So we were looking at natural language inferencing and zero shot transfer for that. English was the pivot. And we were seeing, so obviously English had the highest accuracy, but we were testing it on a bunch of other languages, and we were seeing for negation, when the sentence had negation, how was the accuracy of the sentiment detector affected? And turns out that whatever we achieve for English, which I assume as zero, I mean, it's a high number, let's say 90%. So I make 90 the zero. And then Spanish is 1.3 points below it. French is 2.2% below it and so on and so forth, right? And all the languages are in the same ballpark. Swahili is 23 points below it. Somehow, zero-shot transfer for negative sentences don't work at all for Swahili. So we were surprised why this is happening. You know, in general, yeah, Swahili has less data, but Hindi too has less data. Why Swahili is particularly being affected, especially in negation? Turns out that the way negation happens in Swahili is very different than all the other languages in the set. In all the other languages, there are negative particles like na, nahi, no, and so on. Swahili was a language where there was no negative particle which was prominently used. There were negative particles, but the prominent use of negation was through these morphological, you know, markers. So let's say the pronoun would change depending on whether it's a negation. So in general, you know, if I say I am not singing, I am singing, I will say ninaimba. If I am saying I am not singing, it becomes simbi. So similarly, we are not singing is hatuimbi, but we are singing is tunaimba. So you see this si, hatu, hu, ham, these suffixes, sorry, prefixes, which are put to the pronouns, actually marks the negation. And none of these languages had this. So zero shot transfer and this pre-training and nothing helped. So we have to be very mindful of these typological features when we make, you know, these models and when we select our data. So a lot of effort in the NLP recently has been creating typologically diverse data sets for training and testing of these models. So, okay, now we know which languages are left out and what are some of the, you know, things which hurt. So typological features not being covered hurt and so on. Now, what can we do? What should we do? The first answer we all know is basically create more labeled data and multilingual test benches. Now, this is, I mean, this is the obvious thing to do. And, you know, this graph actually shows the different multilingual test benches that are available. X-axis shows how many languages are there in these test benches and Y-axis shows, you know, how many tasks are there in these. So, you know, XBlue, for instance, has a large number of tasks covered, but fewer languages, whereas WikiNN has only one task, which is named entity recognition, but a large number of languages, 100 plus languages. So you see, for most of the languages and tasks, we will be here, right? And you don't have even more than 10 or 20 languages being covered for testing. So creating test data is of utmost importance because unless you test, you don't even know whether it works or not. Once you have created test data, you should create a little bit of labeled data for fine tuning and a lot of unlabeled data for pre-training. So this is understood. But can we do more? So if you look at, you know, how a language proceeds from class 0 to class 1 to class 3 and so on. So we call it the upward mobility of the languages through the technology hierarchy, right? So we looked at all, you know, historically the papers published in this, you know, NLP literature and technology across these various languages and tried to figure out the pattern. It turns out that class 0 languages are typically exclusive communities, and even the researchers are exclusive communities. I mean, this one person works on this one language, or this one group works on this one language. Nobody else on Earth works on that language. And class 1 to 3, we see a fairly distributed number of researchers working around the world, but mostly the language is used as a, you know, example. So like I gave Swahili as an example, right? But I don't work on Swahili. So these researchers use, you know, let's say they will say it doesn't work for this phenomenon in Urdu. It doesn't work for that thing in Konkani. But they're not really working on Urdu or Konkani. So the languages get a lot of mentions in the NLP literature, but you hardly see much real solid work happening. So this is what we have seen in class 1, 2, 3. And class 4, 5 is when the language has, you know, traversed the hierarchy and it's at the top. So it has both a broad spectrum of researchers and there are a lot of people working on it. What are these enablers? So the first enabler from 0 to class 1 to 3 looks like availability of public data for testing and training. And the second enabler, which is more important, is first is these data sets have to be much, much larger of the scales I had mentioned earlier, but there must be economic incentives of working on these languages. And again, I mean, for Indian languages, I think it's all positive. I mean, we do have economic incentives. India is such a large country. So many people use their language, these languages and all, right? So there should not be any reason why all, you know, at least the 22 Indian languages doesn't come here at 4 or 5. So I'm pretty hopeful. But we have to make sure that we don't break this, you know, upward mobility path. I don't have time to get into the detail of a particular issue of fairness across languages, but I will just mention one thing. So when you train these multilingual models, right, how do you know model A is better than model B? Typically, what we do is we test it on a bunch of tasks on a bunch of languages. We calculate the average accuracy across all languages. And the one with highest average accuracy is declared the winner. So in this case, you know, this particular model, let's say XLMR, would have been declared as the winner. But is it a good choice? If you see, you know, not all languages are benefited by XLMR. For some languages, this other model, MMT, is giving the best result, right? And in fact, if you see one particular language, Japanese, XLMR is giving only 15.9%, which is pretty bad. Whereas using another model like MBERT, you would get 49.2, or even MMT gives you 48.6. So probably average is not a good indicator. Average is not a fair indicator, right, when we are selecting these models. So this is an issue we raised in one of our recent papers in AAAI earlier this year. And the question we asked is, what should be a fair way of selecting the model if it is not average? And turns out that economists, including Amartya Sen, had worked a lot on this. So this is called in economics, the principles of distributive justice or social choice theory. So we could apply those principles here. And a very simple principle, which was provided by an economist called John Rawls, called the Rawlsian or the prioritarian choice helps. It's a very simple, I mean, you don't have to read what's written there. It's a very simple principle which says you maximize the minimum. So look at all the languages, and for each model, count the minimum. So for XLMR, as I already said, the minimum is 15.9 for Japanese. For this other model, MMT, the minimum is 43.1 for Thai. So according to the Rawlsian choice, you would choose MMT over XLMR because MMT actually maximizes the minimum. In other words, MMT is more fair. It is not depriving any language. So sometimes, you know, by just going for the average, we are being unfair. And if we just go for this Rawlsian choice, we are not compromising on average. Average is still 72.3, only 3 points lower. But you see, for a language like Japanese or Thai, how much benefit MMT is giving, right? 20-30% more. So this is something also important to keep in mind, these fairness factors. So summarizing awareness and fairness. So what should we do? So first is we should have the awareness and the issues of fairness. So I don't need to tell this to this community, but often when we go to ACL and such venues, we do tell them this, that, hey, whenever you are publishing any NLP paper, just don't work on English and say that you are done and it works for all languages. You should specifically note down which languages you are working on, why it works on these languages, which languages you might be leaving out, and all these things you should include. In fact, we propose that there should be a diversity and inclusion clause for all NLP publications. So this was also proposed earlier by similar thing was asked by a Professor Emily Bender. So it's called Bender rule. A related rule is also called Bender rule in NLP, that you have to call out the languages that you are working on. Because most of the time people would work on English and French and then say that it is a universal model or a language agnostic model. That shouldn't be the case. Then the other thing is, whenever you are, you know, building these massively multilingual models and choosing one over another, you should at least explain your assumptions like fairness criteria and all that. And there could be alternative leaderboards, right? So I told you everybody is after building these models. I gave you 4 examples in the beginning. So there are leaderboards of these models, and these leaderboards are based on averages. So we said, instead of averages, do Rawlsian, do other kind of weighted average, other kind of criteria. Average should not be the only criteria to include, you know, get more fairness into the system. Also important are some bits of current wisdom that people have come through a lot of empirical studies. Now, this is important to note that neural networks are great, but we know very little we understand very little on why they work, how they work, and so on. So therefore, a lot of the studies are empirical, and every paper tells us something new. Like, you should do this, then it works. You should do that, then it works, and so on. So I think the most important wisdom, piece of wisdom, is that instead of zero-shot learning, one should try few-shot learning. Try to get at least some labeled data, maybe even 100 labeled examples in your language, and you will see great, you know, benefits in accuracy. So going for purely zero shot is not a good idea. So this is, you know, what this means is for each and every Indian language, we can make very small, tiny data sets, 100 examples, 1,000 examples, but for a large number of tasks. This itself will take us a long way, you know, and similarly for testing those systems, we need these data sets. So more diversity, more coverage, not necessarily very large when we are going for labeled data set, because very large is good, but it is expensive. Then language family-based models help, actually. So languages which share a large amount of vocabulary, share script, share, you know, typological features, if you put them together and build models for them together, it helps. That's why a model like Mural or IndicBERT might give, you know, better results for Indian languages than a general, more general MBERT, because they are more customized for Indian languages. So more effort can be put in that direction. And sometimes, you know, for very low resource languages, non-neural techniques or rule-based techniques work better. And this is something which we shouldn't forget. You know, everybody is doing neural doesn't mean we also have to do neural. We have to check out, you know, what works best for our situation. Finally, you know, all through the talk, I've been talking about, you know, languages. But essentially, technology is for not for the language, but for the language users. We are trying to help the users to use their own language by supporting the technology for that language. So eventually, we have to decide, you know, based on the user's need, what kind of technology should be built in a particular language and accordingly invest on the data sets. This is often missing. I mean, certain things are obvious, right? Get a large amount of speech corpora or text corpora, which LDCIL is doing, Girish has talked about, TDIL is doing. These are all useful. These are always useful. But beyond that, if you want to collect a large number of task-specific data, which tasks you should prioritize on, this should be, I think, based on the need of the communities also. So understanding the language communities is extremely important. And we have a project around that in our lab called Enabling the Speakers of Low-Resource Languages. So we don't call it enabling low-resource languages. We say enabling the speakers of low-resource languages. So the speaker is important here. With that, let me thank you again for inviting me to, for this talk. And I hope I didn't take longer than the stipulated time. We should certain, I mean, this image is of a girl who speaks Mundari. And we were doing in this workshop and she was teaching us how to write the Mundari Vani, as they say. You know, through this interactions, what we learn is what they need, you know, what the community need to survival of the Mundari language was very different from, let's say, what we want to support for Bangla or even another very low resource language like Gondi. So again, you know, understanding and talking to the users, especially in extreme low resource scenarios, is very, very important. And with that, you know, final words, I want to thank you again.
Thank you. Clap for Manojit, please.
Manojit Chaudhary for an excellent talk.
Thank you.
Great session, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay, so we'll take a couple of questions. One question from Gayatri Venugopal. Thank you for brilliant talk. There is a lot to take away from this session. My question is, accuracy the chosen metric to test the performance of all the models? If so, is there any reason for inferring the results based on accuracy alone as opposed to other metrics such as AUC score, F1, etc.?
No, that's a great question and I should have clarified it. So when I said accuracy, I just used it as an umbrella term for performance. What I should have said is performance measure of the you know, system. And just to make sure that all of them can be put in the same graph, so people scale it. So some of the performance measures like, you know, precision recall are always between 0 and 1, so you can scale it up easily. But some measures may not be. So essentially, when I was saying accuracy, it covers, in some cases it was, you know, F score, in some cases it was AUC, in some cases in translation it was blue score. So it was very different things. So yeah, no, accuracy is not the only measure, and different tasks and different situations would call for different measures.
Thank you, Manojit. I don't have a question, but I rather have a query. Being a linguist, I'm not a technologist like you, and I think a couple of times I've had the chance to hear you, and wherever I hear you, I get a lot of insights. And this question of this GPT model or deep learning model requiring unlabeled data and working with that, and you have already said that that is not always true, and the work that we are doing at LDCI, let's say doing POS tagging and other things, would still be useful. Do you have conviction to say that yes, what you are doing is yes, very well, you go ahead, do more of this, and we get more? Otherwise, let's say that, for example, we take one pivot language as English and other languages get unbenefited, they get hurt by this.
Yeah.
So something for us, the linguists.
No, I think there is a lot there for linguists, actually. Like I said, we really don't even understand well, you know, why these models work, when these models work, when these models fail, and so on. This Swahili example I had shown is only a linguist, I mean, is equipped to do those kind of studies, right? Like what typological features are important, which are not getting covered, and all these kinds of things. So I would say there are two points here. One is post-tagging data set, morphology data set, and all these things are useful for two things. One is when you are building a model, let's say a large model, you want to just probe it. You want to find out whether it really understands Hindi parts of speech, whether it understands Oriya morphology. Then you can definitely use these data sets. And even for English people do, you know, probe these models with these data sets. So this is certainly one use. The second use is, you know, as I said, for some, I mean, I'm quite sure that for languages like Hindi, Bengali, Tamil, we don't need to go through, you know, rule-based systems again. We have enough data for them to build really large machine learning based systems. However, if we want to go for like the extreme ends of the spectrum, even like a language like Kashmiri may not have enough data very soon. So if you have post-tagging data for them, and that will help you build rule-based systems for them, or more like the classical NLP pipeline sort of systems for them. So, you know, they are always useful. Third point is, you know, for high resource languages like Hindi, Bangla, and all, it might be better to, you know, now no more, we don't invest anymore on low-level tasks and start investing more on high-level tasks like natural language inferencing, speech recognition, of course, but machine translation and those kind of things, sentiment. So those are my high three bits.
Thank you. Thank you. I mean, I wish I had extended this seminar for the whole day instead of wrapping it up in the first half of itself. But anyway, we'll look for some other opportunities again to take it forward, the discussion. And I hope that we have got a lot of guests here who are benefiting out of it. So thank you a lot, Manojit, for coming over and sharing your expert thoughts on this. So we'll now move on to the next session, which is the last session on panel discussion. And I hope I have all of our guests here. So Sonali will introduce the guest for the panel discussion.
Thank you. We have arrived at the last part of today's seminar, which is a panel discussion on language resources and artificial intelligence in Indian languages. For this panel discussion, I'm going to invite all the panelists. Please welcome Shri Ajay Kumar from CDAC Pune, Professor Rohit Sinha from IIT Guwahati, Mr. Rajin B. and team from Samsung, Mr. Raghunandan Chilukuri from Airtel, Dr. Anup Kunjkuttan from Microsoft India Research and Development, and AI for Bharat team. At this moment, I would like to give a brief introduction about each of our panelists here. Shri Ajay Kumar is Associate Director at CDAC, that is a Center for Development of Advanced Computing, the legendary institution which helped the country come up with the supercomputer. Shri Ajay Kumar has been working with CDAC for a long time and is associated with all of its AI and human computer interface related endeavors, engaging in several projects related to language technology. I welcome you, sir, to this panel discussion. The next panelist is Professor Rohit Sinha, is professor at the Guwahati at the Department of Electronics and Electrical Engineering at IIT Guwahati. The research interest of Professor Sinha includes signal processing and pattern recognition with application to spectrum sensing, speech-to-text systems, speech, speaker and language recognition system. Professor Sinha has been a pioneer in these areas for a long time now, supervising and guiding scores of students in this area. Our next panelist is Mr. Rajiv Babu, is currently the technical program manager of the speech recognition team in Samsung Research, Bangalore. Being in this industry for more than 17 years, he stated working on the voice intelligence team in 2018. VIT develops end-to-end system and modules for Samsung's voice assistant, Bixby. His focus is on the technical management of automatic speech recognition related activities. He primarily acts as a bridge between data scientists and product management. Our next panelist is Mr. Raghunandan Chilukuri, is working as senior software engineer in machine learning. He and his team mainly work for bot development and machine learning, which is a part of Airtel X Labs. He has worked on a variety of problems in machine learning, recommender systems, optical character recognition in the past, and working now on speech recognition. Their team at Airtel works on transforming customer care using voice and language-based technologies. They aim to bring these technologies available in multiple Indian languages beyond English on a pan-India scale, serving billions of people. Then we will have Dr. Anup Kunjkuttan, and he is currently working as senior applied researchers at Microsoft AI and Research in the machine translation team in Hyderabad, India. He is also a founding member of AI for Bharat, an initiative at IIT Madras focused on building tools and technologies for Indian languages, NLP. His research areas are natural language processing, machine learning, information extraction, and retrieval. His research interests include multilingual learning, representation learning, lexical and sentence semantics, NLP for related languages, machine translation and transliteration. He is interested in building tools and resources for Indian languages in NLP. Over the last decade, he has contributed to large-scale broad coverage resources like the Indic NLP library, Satta Anuvadak translation system, IIT Bombay parallel corpus, Samanantar corpus, Indic NLP suite, and BrahmiNet. I would like to welcome all of our eminent panelists on behalf of CIL. This panel will be moderated by Dr. Narayan Chaudhary, Officer in Charge of LDCIL and Assistant Director Admin in Charge of CIIL. I would like to request Dr. Narayan Chaudhary to initiate this panel discussion.
Thank you, Sonali, and welcome to all our panelists. Thank you, Professor Sinha, and everybody for joining this. Ajay would not be able to join because he is engaged in a PRSG meeting at TDIL. So we are four of us. So we have already, been for a long time, and you have already seen some of the discussions that we have had. And the goal of why we call for this panel discussion was to engage with the industry people and the academia to seek some ideas or some advice on what we should do as part of, let's say, some takeaways that you can give to us as the government
for schemes like, say, LDCIL. LDCIL is working on developing some corpus. The TDIL is also funding projects to work on different types of language resources development and so on. Now, the industry people, when they are working, they are coming and trying to come up with some kind of a product. What are the things that they require and they are not able to find, where we need to give concentrated effort and then make some takeaways. And these takeaways will be not just for the academics, but also for us. For us, it will be in a way better that we can tell that, okay, these are the priorities that we should pick up in the upcoming time. Now, that would be like, say, for example, someone is developing something for Bodo and he's not finding anything. And there are some complaints, or maybe like, say, for example, Airtel is there. Airtel, some people might complain to Airtel, okay, I want you to give me the things in my language, and Airtel might not be able to support. So what is required for Airtel to do that? Similarly, let's say Samsung. Samsung would be providing smartphones, and smartphone, you need to provide a lot of language support. So what are the languages that you are supporting? What are the languages that you are not able to support? And what are the reasons behind that? So that was our goal for this. And we will take our discussion further on this and get some takeaways from all of this. So we will begin one by one. So being the senior most professor in this panel, I would request that Professor Rohit Sinha to please express his views. And he's also a technologist working for a long time in this area. What has been his experiences in terms of language resources and what we can do to best serve these languages? Sir.
So good afternoon, everybody, my co-panelists, attendees of this webinar, and the viewers of this webinar. It's a great pleasure to be part of this such an important event, as well as this panel discussion. And I sincerely thank LDCIL and particularly Dr. Chaudhary for having me for this particular discussion. As far as the point that Dr. Chaudhary has raised, that what should be the activity, since I basically work in the area of speech recognition and to some extent the speaker recognition and related technologies. And my previous speakers, Dr. Manoj Chaudhary, has basically highlighted some of the recent challenges which are like sort of advancement which are coming up in his field of NLP, and of course that are percolating down to the ASR and other sort of speech related activities. Is basically the too much reliance or maybe interest in the researchers developing about the neural network-based approaches. So in my understanding, currently the LDCIL has really done a human service to express the speech community is concerned. They have created very good quality databases in speech, and of course they have added 11 new languages, and I congratulate the LDCIL for this particular activity, and hopefully this will trigger more research activities on these languages. But when you basically look at the current focus in the ASR or sort of machine translation or speech-to-speech translation, the activities require a large amount of data, and all those activities probably we are yet to take part under the research we can do in the languages which are not Indian origin, because we won't have the databases available to start the activity. So I think in the future, if we can basically also create into some languages a very huge corpus. When I say huge corpus, means I'm thinking of at least not completely labeled data and partly labeled data and partly machine supervised or lightly supervised data of the tune of 1,000 hours or so in some dominant Indian languages, which were sort of can be basically identified, which are all know that what are the languages which are dominant in India. And other thing is that we are, there's so many things that we can add to the current repository at LDCIL. That is probably very little resource which is available in code switching or code missing variety of the speech. I happen to have some interest in this area, particularly for developing the code switching ASR system. So we could not find appropriate data, and we collected a small amount of data. So I would basically suggest, in my humble understanding, data collection is a very specialized exercise, and it cannot be basically done by all and sundry, and requires a lot of resources, planning, and training before we can do it. A research college, when it comes to doing any research in a particular area, and he or she is lacking data, and if he collects a lot of wastage of time, and apart from that, that particular data is not available to the by the research community, and the activity goes waste. And I would basically think that some collaboration of data collection with the research scholars, if it is viable for both end, could also be looked in the future. Other suggestions that I would have, that probably with the advancement in technology, speech is just not raw speech and text. Psycholinguistics is also being a lot of actively pursued in my institution and across India also. So we can have some databases also for speech linguistics, neurolinguistics involved with the speech. That will also be a good addition to the repository which has been created. And last but not the least, I would basically like to recommend that with either way or sole initiative or with help of some appropriate agency like CDIL or MIT, we can basically float some challenges of system building or for technology development, which will not only highlight already created databases with the LDCIL, or they might give us a guideline for future data collection in languages or the initiative, as Dr. Chaudhary has also pointed out, that we need to focus on some languages where we basically have some commercial activity possible with the speaker base. And so such languages, probably we should create more resources and slightly intensive research so that we are able to demonstrate technology development in Indian languages, which we are very greatly lacking compared to Western countries. With this, I would like to finish my submission.
Thank you, sir. So, because you are at Guwahati, I think you might have already seen that we have released two new data sets for ASMEs.
Yes. I'm aware about it. I have taken note of it, and I've basically put students for usage.
So please ask them to use it and give their feedback on how good or bad that data is.
Yes.
So, Rajin.
Thank you so much, Dr. Chaudhary, for inviting me. And thanks to Professor Venkatesh Murthy, Director of CIIL, to put into this effect a wonderful program where a lot of like-minded people are meeting each other. And it's a great initiative to share and know about a lot of databases and different systems and so on. Thanks to the previous speakers of TDIL, Professor Girish Jha and Dr. Manojit too. It was quite a learning session, especially for me. Now, I would also like to thank Dr. Rohit, who actually stole a lot of my words, which I was trying to speak on similar lines. Here in Samsung Electronics, we are seeing that people have started to use language to communicate with the devices more than ever before. So language has become a very key input for the devices, rather than what we used to have, some buttons and so on. Now individuals are coming up with the necessity, who is challenging us with the necessity of language as the input for the devices. At Samsung, I work on Bixby, which is Samsung's voice assistant. Our researchers in the field of ASR, we have researchers in the field of NLU, NLG, we have speech synthesis members there. We have researchers in the field of client and the server platform too. Other teams we have as a input, as a language input, we have embedded keyboards where these keyboards does auto correction for the inputted language. We have auto correction, we have auto suggestions in those keyboards embedded. We also have handwriting recognition system. We also have translation systems. So all these require languages. software language and training and so on. So we work both on global and local products. And recently we inaugurated the Bixby for Indian languages, where people of with Indian English accent can use the Bixby well. So having said that, the language is ever evolving, and they are very persuasive as well. And new vocabulary keep creeping in into the language. You know, 2 years back, or we would have never heard the word COVID shield. Now that word is so popular. So when users start using such words and request the devices about what is COVID shield and so on and so forth, it becomes important for us to be updated from the language point of view. We find the SMS or the texting style languages creeping in, like IMO, OMG, LOL, which is not a part of a standard vocabulary of any language. And also the previous speaker spoke about multilingual, mixed languages, code switching. We have noisy environment. The speaker is speaking very close to the mic, or speaker is speaking very far from the mic. And also we have the speed at which the speaker speaks. Some speakers speak, say, 5 words per minute. Some would say speak at 50 words per minute. And we have the influence of the mother tongue of these speakers. So all these are demanding us to keep our models updated with what is latest. And this I would call as what I personally call as a human in the loop problem. So wherever human is in the loop, we need to keep ever evolving on all the technologies that work for human beings, and where the inputs are so direct as language. So in this regard, I would request CIIL to think of coming up with resources that are very latest, not updated, and which uses the language of the recent days. What does finally all these systems need to benefit human beings at the end of the day? And what is that that human beings are asking for, especially in Indian context? What do they want? Are they requiring some specific need from a technology point of view? Probably we can all, as an industry and academic collaboration, we can think of a lot of resources where we can define what is the data set that is required and how much is required to tackle some prominent problems in the present age. Samsung, we have two broad phases. One is where we work on the commercialization aspect, where we immediately deliver our models so that the users can use it. And we also have the research part of it, where we collaborate with top universities and we engage students' communities. And so that, you know, we build a local ecosystem, and there's always a culture of open innovation happening. So here we have in Samsung what is called as a PRISM program, preparing and inspiring student minds. Engage with a lot of universities and colleges across India. And currently we are at 25 colleges, and more than 500 students are engaged in this program. We give them some problem statement, like code switching, or how to identify language, or speaker verification, and so on and so forth. And there we encourage the young minds to think from the language perspective would benefit India at the long run. So this is another area where, you know, the academic institutions can contact you for a lot of data and try to inspire those young minds to work on the language area. Also, what I would request CIIL is, we can start a speech recognition system, or any system which is language dependent, with a low resource to bootstrap with. And you can, as Dr. Rohit mentioned, you can come up with a lot of unlabeled data, which we can use them in a semi-supervised or a self-loop supervised manner. Initially, we bootstrap with the labeled data, and slowly we introduce this unlabeled data. How all these converge to make a good product or not. So yes, and the third point I would like to make is that, you know, AI is quite unique when it comes to the training data. Some which can play chess cannot do a speech recognition. Data that can be used for speech recognition cannot be used for natural language understanding. So there is a clear purpose of a given data. So when CIIL or anybody which releases data, if it can specifically say, okay, this particular data can be used for this particular purpose, then it would be quite fast. Because as we would all heard that, you know, oil is, data is the new oil, but we need to understand oil is crude. to bring value out of it. Same is the case with data. Just data will not make any sense. We need to refine it to the purpose for which it is used for. So at CIIL itself, if you can distill it in a way that there's a clear purpose of a given database, it would definitely help. Stop here. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rajan. I can understand that. I know that you have seen the LDCL raw speech corpus, and you might have faced problem for any kind of ESR development with that, because that is not sentence annotated. But rest assured that all the data set that you have got, in the next release, we are going to come up with the sentence annotated one. So once the sentence annotated one is coming out, and once you get it, you will not need to do any additional work on annotating it and making it useful for the ESR. That will be readily used. So I was expecting that people who were accessing it, they would be making some use of the raw speech data also, not just the annotated one. Annotated one will also come. One part. Another part, I know that at Samsung, you are also providing this predictive search things, and you would require the text speech corpus for that. The raw speech data, the raw text data that we have released for any of the languages, that is very useful. It is useful because the data is cleaned. So all the words that you have in that list, you can consider that they are the perfect words. There are no spelling mistakes and they are in the right context. So that can be used for that purpose or different other kinds of models. One part. Another part, you have also said that recent data, latest data that people are using, let's say COVID, no one would have spoken this word just 1 year back. So that is an issue with all of the LDCI analytics data, because we have not yet got any crawl data. And for that, I believe that we need to make some effort towards that. We need to make some efforts toward that. So that will be, of course, kept in mind when we move forward towards this direction. Thank you, Rajan. So next, Anoop, what is your views on the current language resources scenarios and gut feeling on what should be the next steps towards this missing?
Sure. Yeah. Thanks, Narayan. And I really had a good time in the morning. The resources that LDCI has now released has kind of added to what can be done with Indian language data for speech and a little bit of text. Or the data set that was released last year was also sort of good. So what I say is that over the last 4 or 5 years, we have seen a good, decent growth in the availability of data for Indian languages, particularly unlabeled data, and coupled with the advances in deep learning that Monojit talked about, we are at a situation where, at least for the major 10 to 12 languages, we can build quality, reasonably good quality natural language understanding systems, natural language generation systems. At least I can speak of that, since I work mostly on text data. And these pre-trained models sort of have made a big headway. Where can we go forward? How do we go ahead, and what are the directions which we should take where we can actually build really good quality products? Professor Rohit and Mr. Rajan talked about a lot of issues, and those are all really important, valid issues. So some of those probably I also would have wanted to add. So I'll kind of maybe take two or three more specific issues to talk about where I think CIL can really make an impact. So CIL is uniquely positioned, I think, in the sense that you have a good team of linguists along with some technologists where you can sort of work at scale on multiple languages beyond the major ones. And so I think CIL has sort of a role to play when it comes to low resource languages, surely. Second, given the expertise that you have, one major requirement is sort of having good quality data sets for higher level cognitive tasks. I think over the years now, we have done some development of data for basic standard tasks like part of speech, chunking, as well as we've released data sets for raw speech, raw text, etc. But now with all these pre-trained models coming in, we are capable of doing more, right? So say, for example, we can do question answering, right, with a very high level of accuracy. And there are good data sets for that for English and maybe a few other high resource languages. And that's a technology that's really useful. So building a kind of shifting the focus to look at these kind of higher cognitive tasks, say question answering or some language generation tasks, which are even more challenging, right? So machine translation for sure, but beyond that, say summarization or data to text, right? So these are the next frontier of tasks which are challenging. And here, building quality benchmarks. I mean, step one, I think we should be building quality test sets, and that's where you have the expertise and the resources to kind of help build that, which can be available to the community. And beyond that, even go ahead and build reasonable training sets for these data sets, coupled with, say, multilingual learning from English and higher resource languages. We could give a boost to many of these really important tasks, right? So some other tasks, information extraction, right? So information extraction across domains is an important task, and that really needs some real expertise to kind of annotate this data. Say health domain, if you want to do some information extraction about analyzing pathological reports to figure out what was the diagnosis, what were the results. So those kind of things is where expertise can help. As I mentioned, okay, so many of these tasks that I just mentioned are natural language generation systems. And one of the issues that we have with these systems is, how do you even evaluate the quality of the output that these systems are generating? So today we take recourse to a lot of automated metrics, say blue, rouge, and some new metrics based on deep learning like BERT score, etc. But they are sort of inadequate. They don't capture all the rich facets that natural language output should have. Say, for example, summarization, does it really capture the central topic of the article? Is the summary coherent, consistent? Are there unnecessary facts that have come into the summary, right? So how do we evaluate this? So we need a lot of work to come up with the good metrics for evaluating these kind of tasks. And to develop these metrics itself will require more annotated data. Say, take a summary, and then we need annotations on, say, its consistency, its coherence, does it cover the topic well, and so on and so forth. And that can be sort of data for benchmarking the evaluation metrics, and maybe even training a new class of evaluation metrics. And that's really work that needs expertise, and that's something that would be something that CIL can help with. Finally, yeah, I mean, I just mentioned that briefly, and I think the previous panelists also mentioned it, that so we need to see how we can serve beyond the 10 or 12 major languages, and you have been releasing data sets beyond these languages as well, and you're uniquely positioned, and that would be a real help if you can help curate not just unlabeled data sets, but even benchmark data sets for different tasks for under-resourced languages. Help build a community of annotators that companies if like us, when we need some annotation data done, can reach out. Because these are skills that, these language skills might be something that are very difficult to find at times. So yeah, overall, yeah, that's kind of what I had to put in terms of where we can focus on, and then kind of take the next level of steps from where we are today to the next set of challenges that can be addressed in the Indian language NLP scenario. Thanks for that, I'll stop.
Thank you, Anup. Some of the points are really very nice. Like say you said, we can develop. Of course, we are uniquely positioned because we have access to several types of people across languages, and we request them to help us in working with these things. Industry or some other organizations, they indulge into these things only when they say they see some profit out of it. But we do not go into that, and we are committed to help promote all the 22 CDO languages to begin with through the part of this scheme, and of course other languages through other projects that we have. And since last few years, I think we have not been doing much of the training part, but I think we are still inviting people to come over here, train them to work on different types of tasks, and then move forward. That said, some of the tasks that you have mentioned are high-end tasks. And like say, for example, summarization or information extraction, language generation. We are not a technologist, and to tell you the truth, at CIL, we do not have a single technology person.
Okay.
I'm also a linguist, but I have some experience of working with technologists, so I have some knowledge of technology, but I'm not a core technologist person. I'm primarily a linguist. So that is always an issue. But we are always open to work with any organizations and collaborate with the developing new kind of technologies that can be leveraged at our end, and our resources that we have that can be used to get garner more data that can go to the public for use. So if let's say your AI Bharat program has something where you think we can collaborate, then of course we would be open towards that. And not just for these 22 CDO languages. Like say we have a scheme called Scheme for Protection for Endangered Languages, SPEL. There we have worked on around 64 lesser known languages which are spoken by less than 10,000 people. Now there are, of course, you would not require any annotation for that kind, because they are so small language that would be of no use. You won't have a user base for that. But for major languages, or even for the varieties, like say in one of the questions that was asked over this chat box, someone was saying that, are you developing anything for Rajasthani? Are you developing anything for Awadhi or Magahi? Now, see, these are also major varieties or major languages having more than 10 million speakers each. Now, so when we say Rajasthani, then in Rajasthani, we do not have any data, but that can be done. That can be done. Even if it is not the CDO language, and this scheme has the mandate to work for all the CDO languages, we can still go ahead for that. Consider, okay, that is also a variety, because speech, whenever you come to speech is something that is different. And you have to cover all the varieties. And when you go for the varieties, you need to take all those data. So at LDCL, we have not yet done, but of course, we have some plans that we can get extended into that part, one part. Like say, for example, in Hindi, well, we said that the Hindi data, speech data we have released, the only one variety that we have is of UP and some of Delhi, not more than, but Hindi is a pan-Indian thing. We need to collect samples of Hindi from Andaman, from Rajasthan, from Gujarat, from Arunachal Pradesh, from South India, everywhere. Wherever it is being spoken, we need to cover all. Let's say, for example, how is English being covered? English has so many varieties. We are working on Indian English. We are working on Bengali variant of Indian English, Kannada variant of English. Why not Bengali variant of Hindi? Why not Tamil variant of Hindi? Why not Andamanese? There are some research papers on Andamans where Hindi is the lingua franca, and there is a specific thing. There are specific linguistic features for that. Similarly, in the case with Arunachal Hindi. So those things, of course, we'll indulge into, and gradually, as we move forward towards this. Yes, so that was my thought, and I believe that we will gradually move towards all of this and get our language resources developed. Now, we also have Raghu Chinkuri. Are you there,
Raghu? Yes, yes, I am here. Yes.
We cannot see you.
Okay, yeah. 1 second, I'm just turning on my camera.
Yes, yes, yes. So Raghu is from Airtel, and he'll be sharing his ideas on
that. Hi, hello. Yeah, thank you for having me. And it was a really nice session. So my perspective will be of a sort of fresh researcher or engineer in the field of speech recognition and text-to-speech, speech generation. So one thing I would like to say upfront is that when you say different dialects or different, for example, I take the example of Hindi, and whenever I see a corpus mentioning different, we have different dialects of Hindi or different accents of Hindi, like they almost read from a given text, read text, and it doesn't almost accurately represent what they speak, because the text is sort of standardized language, sort of standardized central dialect or whatever. For Hindi, it is Khadi Bodhi. So even when we are using different speakers, the speech of different speakers, the underlying text is always the same. So we do not exploit we do not use the actual diversity of the language. So that is one thing I've observed in some speech corpora. And coming to CIL or LDC or TDIL's tools, most of the tools, I'm sorry to say that most of the tools are outdated, because they provide Chrome and Firefox plugins for TTS. And I've tried it several times. They don't work with the new versions of
browsers. Let me interrupt you, Raghu. It's because we are not a technologist, okay?
Yeah, I understand that. That's why I said it is TDIL, not CILs. But so I know, I'll tell the background of why I had encountered this problem, because if you see our Airtel app, we have already released a model. But the thing is, most of the calls we get are from rural UP and elsewhere. We have a Hindi speech recognition model. But whenever the call center agent or someone puts the user on hold, they do not understand the difference between the user and the generated speech. So if the generated speech is there, it will say, "Aap kripya line mein bane rahiye, aapko hold mein rakha gaya hai," and something like that. But he doesn't understand it's a generated speech, IVR speech, and the user continues to speak. We have seen this in mostly rural calls coming from rural areas. So I wanted to use this TTS plugin so that we generate some speech on our test data and see that our model is able to recognize generated speech and actual user speech. We had to differentiate between that, so that we'll say we'll be able to serve our customers better. So, we later built several TTS models for ourselves internally, but I would say this is updating the tools. The core aspect of this is updating the tools. Whenever we are talking of academia or open source hobbyist or self-learners, because with the advent of NPTEL and massive online courses, open online courses, there are a lot of people who get the start in machine learning or directly deep learning, in fact, in NLP and both speech technologies. So it would be nice to have an ecosystem of tools. Data is okay. There are challenges in freely distributing the data versus the finances, balancing the finances. But that even the tools ecosystem is not so well developed. And secondly, I'd like to see more models as opposed to data. Even if you cannot release the data, I'd like to see models released. And this also has rooting in my experience while working for a project, because we used a speech recognition model from one of the big Silicon Valley companies. And obviously they did it on English. They developed a huge model on English and it was wildly successful. Even for Indian English, it worked fine, very well. So we were able to deploy. But when it comes to Indian languages are agglutinative in nature. So you add words together, words clump together, and each letter we see is actually multiple Unicode points, like kha yega kha plus a ki matra, ya and a ki matra, and there are. So whatever the architectures are developed for English were not translating well to Indian languages. So this is one aspect which when we had filed bug reports and worked with the company there, and actually we developed the R&D team, we contacted the R&D team there, and then we were able to modify our architecture and things like that. So for us, we were a big company, so we were able to contact them and all that. But for a small startup or even academia or freelance researchers, they won't be able to get the resources, spend some time to talk to people there, and modify the models. Deep learning architectures or even machine learning. Forget deep learning, even machine learning architectures. There are tricks of trade which work for English and other European languages, which may not translate for Indian languages. So, that work we have worked only in 4 or 5 Indian languages other than English. So it has worked so far, but there's no guarantee that what we have developed so far for Hindi or Tamil or Telugu may translate to, say, Northeast languages. We haven't explored that part yet. So that is one place where translating what model or what architecture or what algorithm work best for Indian or English or high resource languages is not guaranteed to work on Indian languages. So this is a technology perspective. I understand it's CIL doesn't directly develop models, but this is one aspect which as a community we have to consider for developing better models and making use of the best use of our data. I think those are the points I wanted to make. Thank you.
Thank you, Raghu. I have one additional question for you. In your suggestion, do you see something that we could do for better? I think you suggested that we could add more varieties for Hindi.
Yes. So, yeah, Hindi specifically, we used your data, and we have IIT Madras has created a speech ASR challenge. So they said, the speakers are tagged by location, but most of them do read a given text. It's a given text, so they're accent or something doesn't come out really. It's just they're reading the text presented to them mostly.
Yes, yes.
So one way to alleviate this is a crowdsource model like Common Voice uses. So speakers speak that, and maybe there is somebody who uptick or downtick, I mean upvote or downvote it. It's not as effective as curated sources like CIS data, but I mean we'll be able to collect more diverse data, more accents, dialects, regions, and for example Eastern UP versus Khadiboli, which is Western UP. So
yes, Hindi, for Hindi I agree that we have not covered pretty well, but for some other level, let's say for example Kannada, we have got four varieties.
Yes, Telugu you have three varieties, but I mean this crowdsourcing portal can help us get more semi-supervised data. I mean, we can be sure of the basic quality. It may not be up to the highest standard, but it has a sanity check done and basic quality is maintained, so we can use in semi-supervised scenarios or things like that.
Yep. That is certainly helpful and a good feedback for all of us. Okay, so I think we have got some good feedback that I would like to take it to my PAC in the next meeting and take it and see where we can take it forward from here. So, anything else that any of the panel experts, panelists would like to express, comment on? No. Okay, so I think it is almost, we are running 20 minutes ahead of the schedule, and we would like to close so that we have not taken a single breath from 9:30 till now. We are going on continuously. So we call it to a close. And so, Sonali?
Yes, sir. Thanks to all our panel members for this insightful panel discussion. Now it is time to conclude the seminar with the concluding remarks by our own director, CIL, Professor C.G. Venkateshmurthy. Sir, please join us for your concluding remarks.
Thank you, Sonali. Friends, it has been a wonderful experience for all of us alike, I presume. Since morning, ever since we released the data sets, started with the lectures by Sri Deepak, supported by Vivek Raghavan, Professor Girish Nath Jha, Dr. Manojit Chaudhary, all brilliant lectures and very unique way of presentations coupled with so much of conviction on what they were talking. And added to that, we also had a panel discussion where the four experts shared their concerns, gave their views as to what could be done on the language resources and the AI in the Indian languages context. Brilliant. I was wondering that in such a short span of time, how could we achieve so much today? Very tight sessions. And I'm appreciative of the fact that all the panelists and then the experts who gave the lectures were so professional, who understood the time constraint, yet made such powerful impact on the minds of all of us alike. And your talk and then your inputs have been very, very useful to all of us. And I hope and I suggest to my colleague, Dr. Narayan Chaudhary, to not only get the feedback about the entire seminar from the people who have participated, also to make a team of all these people on the net where we could continue to have this dialogue. This is a beginning from this occasion. Let us not say that now with this concluding remarks, we are done with the whole thing. This should now begin. There are so many issues, so many concerns, so many anxieties, so many solutions which are coming. This give and take, Adan Pradhan must continue. And this should be construed as a platform where all of us, the kind of questions that we are asking, the kind of inquisitiveness that we have from the experts, and the kind of experiences that we have in CIIL, it should be shared. And let this platform continue to grow and quench the thirst of all the people who matter. And this is something like all of us are concerned about one particular goal, and this goal should be such that all of us should be able to contribute. In this direction, I'm sure Dr. Narayan Chaudhary and his entire team in LDCIL will make it a happening place where the dialogue must continue, the support must come. We should be able to understand the needs of the different stakeholders. We must be able to live up to that. And then we will professionally grow along with each one of you. And then with your contribution, with your queries, with your suggestions, and we should be able to make this program a very, very successful one, and we should be able to grow very professional. And this was a very satisfying experience since morning. I have been a witness to every minute that has happened since morning. I enjoyed being a part of this seminar, and hopefully we should be able to have many such programs and activities. We were slightly skeptical when we did not think of for the whole day that perhaps it would be too much to be, you know, attached to this digital platform for the whole day. It might be very strenuous kind of a thing. But then the kind of overwhelming response that we are getting makes us feel that perhaps we should have done it for the whole day, number one. Number two, why not many more such opportunities where these discussions and the dialogue should not continue. I see no reason why we should not have many more opportunities. I congratulate Dr. Narayan Chaudhary and his entire team for having been able to do this so wonderfully well. And I thank all the experts, all the panelists, and all the participants who have made it possible to be here. And with so much of patience and engrossing, you know, environment, you have been able to be a part of this seminar. And I thank each one of you for making this a success. And I'm sure we'll be able to make some kind of a documentation of whatever we have done today. And we should be able to put it to best use, and let us continue our dialogue. This is not the end, and this is the beginning. I hope my intent is understood by my team, and we will try and see how we can continue our dialogue. Thank you very much for this wonderful opportunity to all of you, those of you who are available online right here, and those of you who are witnessing this whole activity on the other social media platforms. Thank you very much. We should be able to have a continued dialogue, and let's all continue to grow together. Thank you very much. And we are done from CIA. Namaskar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Guruji. Thank you for your kind words. It's a pleasure to be part of this.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Sonali, we can wrap it up.
Yes. I would like to thank all dignitaries, panelists, and all the participants to join the seminar and make it a great success. Especially in this turbulent health situation, I wish everyone to be safe and healthy so that we can continue this process of language development. Thank you all.
Thank you all. Good day to all of you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.